There is nothing. Only warm primordial blackness. Your conscious ferments in it. No larger than a single grain of malt. You don't have to do anything anymore. Ever. Never, ever. Never, ever, ever, baby. An inordinate amount of time passes. It is utterly void of struggle. No ex-wives are contained within it. Yes, it is. You got it, sweet brother. Nothing upon nothing upon nothing. Coming right up, sir. Smooth passage. Do you really?
You wouldn't like it if I told you what was back there. Why'd you think you had to bludgeon yourself into oblivion? Or did you not sense yourself marinating? Poured so much on yourself, got a bit carried away, did we, Chef?
Fear and apprehension. You should ask what's out there first.
Somewhere in the sore, bloated man-meter around you. A sensation. Like a fly to the ointment, your conscious sticks to it. The limbed and headed machine of pain and undignified suffering is firing up again. It wants to walk the desert. Hurting. Longing. Dancing to disco music.
The stench of liquor rises from your mouth, and with it, an ungodly headache. A fiery streak penetrates your skull, trying to force your eyes open. It's a sound, a clarion call from hell.
A mirror hangs above a bent and broken sink. In a fierce discharge of masculine energy, someone has ripped half the faucet off. Hot water sprays from the base and steam covers the mirror. You cannot see yourself, just the outline of a man. Suddenly, you realize you have no memory of the face that awaits you there, underneath the soft vapor. As you slowly reach your hand towards the surface of the mirror, abort. You clearly have not thought this through. You won't like what you see there, and you will never unbecome it. Yeah, there is definitely something wrong with it. Where to even begin? There is the bloatedness, then the swollenness. It's like there's an upholstery of alcohol underneath your skin. It's not. It's swollen and snail-like. Wriggling between your fingers. It's not. Your nose feels like a small balloon in the middle of your face. It hurts when you honk it. It doesn't appear to be a particularly tiny nose either. Not with all the drinks it's absorbed for you. Don't be scared. It's only your face. It's not like anyone's going to see it. Behold. You have no idea who this thing is. Do you? Whatever it is, at least it's dead now. There's clearly rigor mortis on your face. Oh, wait. Is that an expression? Are you trying to make an expression with that face? Please stop. It's horrible. You're scaring yourself. You can't, can you? It's like it's not even voluntary anymore. You have worn that grin into your face, and now it won't come off. What does it even mean? What is the emotion you're trying to convey? Please promise yourself you are not going to try it on any of the ladies, whatever happens. You liar. You can't even tell the truth to yourself. Go ahead. Try something. This fan has two chain pull switches. One ends in a tiny fan, the other in a light bulb. A truly horrific necktie has somehow attached itself to one of the blades. You reach out to grab the tie, but what's this? Diffuse, radiating chest pain. Doom comes over you. This is bad. Feels like sharp stones grinding in your chest and keeping you from moving. For quite a long time. Still ongoing. Now is a good time to start worrying. Finally, the pressure recedes. You find yourself covered in cold sweat and trying not to move, hoping it will keep you from dying. The blades come squeaking to a halt. It should be easier to reach the tie now. You swoop up and catch the tie. Snap! It's released from the blade. What you have in your hand is a truly hideous necktie, with four or five different patterns. The knot reminds you of a noose. You hear a jingle. Keys are clinking in the pocket of your flare-cut pants. It says, whirling in rags, on the aluminium key ring. There is a single key on the ring. The number one is etched on it. It should open the door. The window stands broken in its frame. Cold wind blows in. What do you mean? Assess the damage. How would you do that? What are you even trying to do? The morning light hurts your eyes. It's hazy, but you see the ocean and some war-torn buildings. Thank you. There they both are. Two identical shoes. Both copiously green and indiscriminately snakeskin. Reunited on your feet. Good, they're balanced. Comfy. Feels like the only good thing about you right now, truth be told.
Hello, officer.
The young woman raises a cigarette to her lips. Her eyes are brown, and her face is speckled with birthmarks. She can't be more than 28.
No. Because you're a police officer, sir. I'm not, unless you've been shitting us all this time. You've been here for 3 days, on official police business, no less. Couldn't say. In truth, so far, mostly drinking. Don't be so harsh on yourself. They let almost anyone be a police officer. Could it be because of the drinking? Of course. Be careful, officer. They don't like the police around here.
Something stirs in you as she's about to go. Call it an instinct, a need. The need to ask questions. It's like you said the words a million times before. She looks back at you, a light glinting off her eyes.
Yes. The dock workers are pretty cocky. They think they're police enough. At least here on the coast. I can't say about the rest of the city. You're in a hostel, sir. We are in Revachol. You sure look like you're from Revachol. Revachol parties. It's 51. The current century? Centuries don't have numbers. They have names. And this is the current one. Civilization has existed for 8,000 years, sir. You're right. There is nothing funny about civilization. There was the usual ruckus. Loud disco music. I couldn't say. It's impossible to hear people speaking from over here. Oh, yes. Various artists. Ostentatious orchestration prime among them. Oh, were huge where I come from. I was very young then, of course. Like, 7. Life gets hard, but we go on. I don't know about that. At around 2 o'clock, the disco stopped, and there was a change of pace. A slow, sad song started playing, like organ music on repeat. That went on for quite a while. Some of the time, you were yelling along to it. Yes, there was a church in there, a really small church. Like the smallest, saddest church in the whole world. It was about that. And also, that it doesn't matter anymore and that we're alone now. It was difficult to tell. The song itself was very quiet and soft, but you sounded like a wounded boar, sir. It was hard to understand what you were singing on top of it. Yes. It was very cool. Then you started screaming and trashed the place. A window was smashed. A tape player, probably. The song stopped. And furniture, too. A real destructathon. There was screaming. Then I think you passed out. There was. I think you screamed that you didn't want to be this type of animal anymore. I may have misheard, but it was sort of memorable. I went out afterwards. Everything was quiet by then, around 4 or 5. And that was it. Glad to have been of assistance.
You should pick that fat, juicy cigarette butt from the tray. Light it up and smoke the living shit out of it. Who knows what you are? A monster, A murderer? The Gnome of Jeroma? You feel like a smoker, especially when you look at that juicy, succulent, seductive cigarette stub, still smoldering deliciously. How very astute of you. This renders it ineffectual. You should look for a whole cigarette, or better yet, an entire pack. Strike that, a carton. Make sure they're all healthy and able-bodied. Then smoke them all. Good. They'll make you stronger and better. You're too old to be cool now, but find cigarettes, smoke them, blam. Instantly a cool renegade man, a mystical red dragon with smoke rising from his nostrils. Plus, smoking them gives massive bonuses. A bespectacled man in an orange bomber jacket is tapping his foot on the floor. Looks like he's waiting for someone. You, as you approach, he narrows his eyes and extends his hand in greeting. If an assault were launched on this building right now, if the windows came crashing down and the whole world descended upon you, this man would hurl himself in death's way to save you. You are sure of this, but why? He is your half-brother.
Hello, I'm Kim Kitsuragi, Lieutenant, Precinct 57. You must be from the 41st.
You realize he is waiting for your name. This is your chance to come up with a really good name for yourself. Get creative. Conceptualize. Concentration makes you squint your eyes. Your name should be deep gold and orange, like a forest fire looming on the horizon, but mixed with the stench of liquor rising from your breath. You're two steps closer to it, but there are still many to go.
Okay, then. It looks like we had a little scheduling error on Sunday. Saturday too, actually. Have you had time to talk to the manager here? Then we should ask him for a rundown of the area. Get me up to speed. I understand the scene is out back, right? It also wouldn't hurt to assure him the police are finally here. In full force, I mean. Have you mapped out the initial interviews? Right. And the interviews? At the 57th, we like to prepare an initial list of persons of interest and then just skim the surface. Prepare the field, get to know the players. You don't do that? Maybe it's not an inter-district practice. Okay, we'll have time for that after we take a look at the coroner's case. Have you removed the dead body from the tree? Sure, but did you take it down from the tree? So, the body is still in the tree.
This is the first time you detect a weariness in the lieutenant's voice. It is obvious he would have preferred for the body to no longer be in the tree.
Where it has been hanging for 7 days straight. We should go there as soon as we are done talking to the owner. I was sent here to meet a detective from Precinct 41. You have the insignia of the Citizens Militia on your sleeve and on your back. I suppose you could be impersonating him. You could have gotten the insignia from the black market or forged it. But for now, I'm going to set those possibilities aside. I'm not from the Inspectorate General. Yes. They're not just white rectangles. They bear a halogen watermark with the letters RCM and a pattern resembling the street grid of Revachol West. I would ask you to step into the headlights of my motor carriage, but again, it's none of my concern. I just need you to do your job. You mean you don't have a badge? Losing your identification card is a serious matter. My vehicle has a shortwave. You can use it to report your badge missing. I would advise you to locate it as quickly as possible. I can see you drank last night and the night before, and that you are still drunk now. But I have seen officers go through worse. Much worse. If you need something for your headache, there is a general store nearby. But as I said, the dead body should be our number one concern.
A painkiller would be good about now. This thing is pulsating with discomfort. The best cure for a headache is, of course, morphine. They won't have that. So cigarettes will have to do.
After you, officer.
Lieutenant Kitsuragi is now in your party. You can talk to him whenever by interacting with him.
Hello, sweetie.
Wait, who's sweetie?
You're a handsome man, officer, with your mustache and your chiseled jaw and that silly dimple on your chin. But dear, you're not for me. I'm too old and too married, besides. You must forgive me. I'm getting so scatterbrained, I completely forgot to introduce myself. I'm Lena. My husband Morel and I are staying with our friend Gary just down the street, but I come here for tea when they're away.
This Lena is wacky enough for the Motley Crew. Hire her on the spot.
Whatever do you mean? Sequence killers? Oh my. But I think you already have a partner, sweetie.
A partner who needs you to help him get a corpse down from a tree. I can assure you with absolute certainty, there are no sequence killings taking place in Martinez.
Now, gentlemen, no need to squabble. I wouldn't be of much use to you anyway, sweetie. Thank you, but Martinez isn't the most wheelchair-accessible place, you see. I'd slow you down, perhaps another time. Yes, officer. You look rather dazed. Like a stunned fox. But surely things can't be that bad. You know where we are, right? That's right. And where is the Whirling and Rags cafeteria itself located? We're in the city of Revachol, dear. How would I even begin to tell you? Revachol is the most beautiful city in the world. We're fortunate to be here, you and I. I haven't seen very many other cities personally, but everyone says so. Revachol is a rare jewel. This city used to rule the world, though it has seen better days. Speaking of history, you know what year it is, yes? That's right, dear. How splendid. Here, take this pen. Knowledge should always be rewarded.
Her relief is palpable. She was getting pretty worried about you there. But now she relaxes her shoulders. Outside, the melting snow seeps into the cracks in the walls and the cobblestone streets, all the way down into the sewers. Above ground, the first maybells blossom. You can feel it, a great cold. Then the shiver passes.
I can tell that this is taxing for you, so I'll just ask one more question. What regime are we living under? What mode of government? Oh, no. Nothing like that, dear. Revachol is a zone of control led by an alliance of foreign powers called the Coalition. We have almost no government of our own, and certainly not one who's horseback.
Of course. You've arrived at a weak world where no one appreciates animal husbandry.
Oh, dear. This is troubling. You really ought to know that, being one yourself. There aren't any cops in Revachol, not in the traditional sense. The status of law enforcement has been a complicated matter since the revolution. But we should stop for today, sweetie. You look like you need a break. Besides, I'm not the best person to explain the big things to anyone.
She's scared now. She's realized you really are brain damaged.
You didn't do too well, dear. You really only knew what year it is. It does look like you're having trouble remembering things. History and places. Reality, in a word. It's very odd.
A sigh. The lieutenant buries his nose in his notebook.
But maybe a fresh set of eyes is what the world needs. And while I'm no doctor, such bouts of amnesia are often temporary, so I wouldn't worry too much. A defeat, I'm afraid. The people of this archipelago tried to build something new, something different. The rest of the world didn't like it, so they came and ended it. This was 42 years ago. Of course, sweetie, I really don't know how to explain it better. Someone more educated in sweeping matters. Maybe you should ask.
No, I'm not an encyclopedia. I won't be a guide either. I'm a detective.
Of course. Then I don't know. Someone rich, maybe? Wealthy people are educated. Though I don't know where you would find a wealthy person in Martinez. Yes, dear. I'm a paraplegic.
A paraplegic is someone with limited or no ability to use the lower half of their body. Paraplegia is caused by spinal cord injuries, like falling from a great height, or a grenade explosion.
No, dear. I'm not quite that old. Although I was injured in the line of duty. Nothing so extravagant, dear. Though what young girl doesn't dream of soaring over a crowd? I was a training and development manager at a rapidly expanding mail order shoe company. You'd think it would be a safe job, but I had to be everywhere, and, well, once I happened to be under some faulty scaffolding, I was lucky. This was almost 20 years ago, and I was compensated exceptionally well. One can only dream of such payoffs nowadays. That's quite all right. I'm used to people asking questions. I know they're thinking about it anyway. Of course, dear. Good luck with your case.
Impressive beard notices you approaching. He drops the ledger he was holding and turns to the lieutenant.
Mr. Gart, right? You run this place.
Yes.
I am Kim Kitsuragi from Precinct 57. This is an inter-district investigation, so joining me from Precinct 41.
Are you kidding me? It's you. It's obviously you. You smell like liquor. And you're orange.
See? Everyone agrees it's your color scheme. We're on the right track with this name thing.
Is this what you get when you call the police now? We've been waiting for a week here.
Sir, I understand your concern. But we are here to do a job. And for us to do it, I need you to stay calm.
Yes, of course.
I know it took us a while to arrive at the scene, but it also took you a while to call us. It was you who placed the call, correct?
No, I only just got here. It was probably Sylvie who called you. She usually works the bar here. I'm only temporarily taking over her duties.
Do you have her number?
As a matter of fact, I do.
You said you just got here. From where? Are you a local?
What, of Martinez? No. I live in Jamrock. I only sometimes come here to keep an eye on the place. This is just one of the many, many cafeterias I manage.
But you still know your way around, yes? In case we need directions.
Yes, I know where some things are, but as I said, I don't live here. I just used to work here. And I'm not going to start working here again, if that's what you think.
I didn't imply that. Detective. Mm-hmm. I have everything. You?
Yes, yes. He means, do you have questions for me, like a police officer would? I don't know who killed him. I'm not the police. That's your job. What are you, crazy? Of course I didn't kill him.
Suddenly you tense up. Blood is being pushed to your muscles. You should hound him on this. Hound him hard, the prey drive says.
No, I didn't. I didn't. I don't appreciate this. What is this? Do I have to answer him? Is this mandatory?
The lieutenant stands motionless, his expression unreadable.
What are you, an idiot? I told you I haven't killed anyone.
He ignores you.
Behind this building, there's a courtyard. They hoisted him up on a tree there. That's easy. See that door there? First you exit through that. Then, to your right, you should see a big hole in the fence. A really big one. You can get to the courtyard through there. No need for the keys. The hole is big enough for the Franco-Nigerian cavalry to fit through. She went away because none of your business. Extra fine. No, I'm not the bartender. I'm the cafeteria manager. I have three cafeterias I manage. Three. Get over it.
Let's go.
Not so fast. You owe me 130 real.
One moment you're running like the wind, then you've suddenly turned around and are giving him the finger, furiously, with both hands. Why? That's true. Yes. And it's worrying. But let's not fixate on it. Look at that stupid bartender instead. He has no idea what's going on. You and your fuck you fingers floating in the air. Barkeep's got his mouth agape like an idiot. You showed him.
Watch out!
Everything goes dark.
Back so soon. Admit it. You just missed the quarter light. The darkness on the edge of town. I was wrong to let you go. I should have kept you here. Is it bright where you are? Is it terrifying? Have you felt the love?
That is too bad. We all need a little love. Are you okay?
No. You have sustained a trauma to your lower neck. In addition, you have strained your left trapezius muscle. Pain surges down your back when you move.
The chair took the brunt of it. Don't worry.
Are you sure, ma'am?
Yes, yes. Check on him.
Sir, I didn't mean for this to happen. I'm sorry. This has always been a cop-friendly place. The drinks are on the house, okay? There were a lot of drinks on the tab. I still have to charge you for 3 nights and the broken window, though. That's 100 square. Not entirely cool. You still owe me 100 real. If you don't have it by tonight, I can't let you back up there. And for God's sake, watch out for yourself.
By the way, where is home? The address is coming up blank, but you've been at this hostel cafeteria for only 3 nights. Where were you before? You had to be somewhere. Why did you say that?
No. But isn't that an expression, not a place? A saying, up on Marvel Hill, a great high place, one that is impossible to climb back to.
That doesn't sound like somewhere you can stay if you run out of money. Entertain the thought when you get the time. Maybe being a hobo and a cop has its advantages. An old call box with a matrix of push buttons lists all the companies in the East Delta Commerce Center.
The RCM in Martinez. What can I help you with? We don't see a lot of police around here, that's all. Of course. What can I help you with? Of course. Where to? Oh, that. That's right there, in the yard.
She's relieved someone has come for it, finally.
What do you mean? Yes, sir. District of Martinez. This intersection is called Roundabout North.
He knows where we are. He just wants directions.
There's the pier, the Cape Side apartment buildings, some more tenements. Not a lot, really. The harbor gates. Some kind of commotion, I think. I don't follow the local politics. A fleet store, too. Some shops and a bridge. The canal bridge leads to the coast, but it's broken, I think. Some kind of accident, probably. Just coast. There's a little fishing village there, and a fish market. But that got closed down ages ago.
Rows of stalls under a broad roof, where silvery fish were heaped on newspapers. Water everywhere, pouring from the heavens in the shadow of the old church.
Anything else? It's just water. No, actually, I think they call it the Martinez Inlet. There are some islands in the bay, but they're hard to reach. No problem. Me? I am just a gardener. I am working. I have a greenhouse in the yard there. I've been trying to get some work done. Well, as you already know, there's a corpse there, hanging from a tree. It smells pretty bad, so I have to take breaks.
Don't worry, miss. We are here to clean it up. You can get to work soon.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. My head is about to explode from all the salts I've had to inhale. Of course, I won't hold you back.
Her gloves. You get the feeling that you need them. You have a dead body to deal with, after all.
Sure, keep them. I have another pair.
Right in. The store is open. Are you interested in a new and exciting book? It's a bookstore, sir. We sell books, postcards, and some board games. It's called Crime, Romance, and Biographies of Famous People.
Whoa. Hold your horses, little girl.
A postcard is a small cardboard picture You can write a few words on the other side and send it to your friend or beloved. That is a book. They have stories inside them. It's like someone told you a story in a really long letter. Board games are like little games on a table, made to pass the time. There are several different ones, but sailors here mostly buy cards. My pleasure. Anything else you'd like to know? Okay, sir. I'll try to answer any questions you have. I hope my name is Annette, sir. My mum, her name is Plaisance. She owns the store. She's inside minding the register or organising the stock. Feel free to step in and browse our wares. I'm signalling that the store is open. Otherwise, people might not know. They'd miss out on the crime, romance, and biographies of famous people. Oh, no, no, sir. I'm happy to help Mum by luring in customers. Besides, I have some hot juice in my vacuum bottle to keep warm. I do my studies at home at the moment. I have to help Mum keep this place running. Mum says it's necessary to do both because it builds character. Mum says a proper worker is dutiful. That's how you get ahead in life. You succeed.
There is stress and unease behind these words. She's reciting etiquette.
Mum says it's peachy. She was a little afraid at first. There's talk about this house being cursed.
Behind her, the window has been boarded up. You sense the boards creaking, twisting for a second, and some kind of doubt in her tense shoulders.
Cursed in the way that makes them say that no business has ever really thrived here, sir. That they all go... Exactly. But we've been doing fine so far.
We can go into the bookstore and ask about the case. But I don't see much more to look into here.
Yes, please do look at our wares inside. The postcards and board games you asked about are also there, sir. Nothing really, sir. Mum doesn't allow me to sneak around in the back rooms or the cellar. I don't really know what's there.
It does not manifest itself in any way. It does not exist. I liked it better when we were talking about whether it's appropriate to stand out in the freezing weather. No such thing.
Anything else you wanted to talk about, sir? Maybe I can tell you about some of our books instead. Crime fiction is about murders or burglaries or things like that, and the work of a policeman or a private detective who's trying to solve a crime and catch the criminals.
Crime is what we were solving before this conversation began.
It's exciting to people, I guess. They get to imagine dangerous things, and it's kind of like a puzzle where you can guess who the criminal is or how the good guys are going to catch him. You don't look much like a policeman. Didn't mean to offend, sir. Sorry, sir. It's just that you don't look like Dick Mullen. Say that. He's not even real. You're real. Cheer up, sir. It's much easier being a fictional character. He doesn't have to deal with real things. Maybe you can show me some real deductive police work, sir. Like in the books.
You fail to deduce anything substantial. She waits intently.
Come on, don't be silly. That's not a proper deduction. It's the type of book where there's a rich lady and she has to choose between the good man and the bad man. Or there could be a story about a poor lady getting a rich man. It's about man and lady business, sir. It happens, but usually the guy gets rich in the process. Or should actually be rich himself, but has lost his family property unjustly, like during the revolution or something. Those are unhappy books, for most of the pages. People sad about what they have lost, but then it all turns out just fine in the end. These are not very common. You can't have a choice between bad and bad. Nobody wants to read a story like that. Well, maybe then it's fine. Maybe if the lady then decides not to pick either, because she doesn't need a bad man. Yes, that would be interesting. That's really not a proper romance story. That's more like everyday life. Not in romance books, sir. These are about nice and pretty people, and everyone is happy in the end. I haven't read many of those. Maybe you should ask Mum. I don't think it's a romance story if the main characters break up, though. No, I don't know.
You can take this. Blossom like a pain flower. The girl is at a loss for words. She shifts and sways on her feet, looking confused and uncomfortable.
I'm sorry, sir. I don't know how to help you. Sir, I'm still little. I can't...
It's time to leave it be. You're about to make a child cry. Are you proud of yourself?
Mm-hmm. Maybe some about other books? Oh, kings and queens and generals of old, or artists and writers, or musicians, those kinds of people. There's usually something extraordinary about them. I think that's why people read them, to find the secrets of their fame.
Seems like most people who read those books fail to get more famous from reading them.
But it does make the famous people more famous. Why would they do that, sir? That's so cool. Maybe they'll make you a book cover picture and everything. Standing over a dead body, holding a gun.
The girl keeps her hands folded, hidden. Why is that?
What do you mean, sir?
She looks around anxiously. Her hands remain folded in front of her. She doesn't want to show them. The lieutenant stands by, looking at the two of you with little interest. She brings out her reddened hands, her nails frayed, nearly chewed down to the flesh.
And you knew this from me keeping my hands folded? Well, that proves nothing. Anyone could do an easy deduction like that.
She nods, half provocative, half enthusiastic.
Maybe so, sir. Okay, I know it's a bad habit, and I shouldn't. It was okay, sir.
There's more that can be achieved here. Ask her to do the same.
You're quite sober.
The lieutenant does not flinch at the comment. He does not flinch even a single bit. He is intensely not flinching. It takes effort.
Because you usually aren't. I'm sorry, sir. I hope things get better soon.
There she stands, swaying on her feet. Assaulted by the early spring breeze, she smiles at you. The whole situation suddenly feels familiar, somehow. You have absolutely no idea. Familiar? How? You must have forgotten something you heard. Again. striking woman leans against the cabin top of her sailing boat, smiling as you approach. Her green raincoat glistens with droplets. A silk scarf is tied around her throat.
Good morning, officers. I'm Joyce. Joyce L. Messier. I represent the board of Wild Pines, the owners of the harbor. You gentlemen must be from the RCM. Beaton, my maiden name. I meant you, the Revachol Citizens Militia, the police. Nothing, honestly. I've said it to every drunk in town, and you're the first one who's responded. I'm glad to see you here.
Like steel, there is strength there. If she wanted, she could sink her nails deep into your skin.
I was dispatched to handle a strike, not a lynching. Anything I can do to assist the RCM in this matter, I will, gladly.
That is good to hear, madame. My colleague will take the lead on this interview. I should let you know that he is recovering from an unusual medical episode. Very unusual. But I can assure you of his ultimate competency.
How interesting. I wish you a swift recovery. In the meanwhile, you have my full cooperation, and the full cooperation of the Wild Pines group.
Is what you want to say, but it isn't that easy, is it? Look at that lady. Take a gander. Squint your eyes, bub. Why, yes. Tucked away under that sturdy green raincoat, almost rustic in its simplicity, a silk shirt and matching scarf around her gentle throat, while dull orange pearls hang from her earlobes, red from the cold. Her light green eyes scan you, full of knowledge and worry, wealth and all its possibilities. Now look at you, you misery-clad simian. Barely able to tie your own laces. Your armpits are lakes. A scythe of booze precedes you. Your hair sticks to your forehead and your underwear feels uncomfortable. You're poor. Poor as balls. You can't ask this person for money. You're too. You think your little communism protects you from this feeling? No. The more demeaning it is to grovel at her feet.
As I was saying, if there's any way I may be of assistance, please don't hesitate to ask.
I am sorry. It just doesn't come out of your mouth. What does is...
Excuse me? I didn't hear you. Did you say money? Of course. Why, yes, I am. Of course there are. We're on an archipelago. How else are you supposed to get around? Yes, we are. We are on Le Caillou. We are. And the city of Revachol is on the island of Le Caillou. I haven't seen anyone else drive a souped-up Capri Kenema motor carriage either.
Actually, that motor carriage has been specially issued to serve as a patrol and pursuit vehicle. It's for crossing long distances in a greater Revachol industrial harbor. It's not a toy.
Neither is this. A toy, I mean. It's a machine for crossing long distances in the Bay of Revachol, between the city and the islands. The boat? No. It is called Cor de Lady 19, because that's the type of sloop it is. It's a pleasure craft, a 19 pacer. It also happens to be rated for Category 1 racing. Though these days I mainly use it for business. My sloop, I like it a lot. It's the eel's hips, baby.
I'm enjoying this part of the interview. It has so little to do with the murder we're investigating.
I really do, the lieutenant thinks. Is she thrown off yet? He's looking at the woman, assessing her.
Officer, I assure you I'm a highly qualified pleasure craft operator.
The crowns of her teeth are porcelain, white as the boat's hull as she smiles. Qualified pleasure craft operator. So charming. Where's the damn license?
I just renewed its safety inspection last month, officers. It is completely seaworthy. In fact, it's taken part in not one, but two insulindic regattas. Even finished once. The other time, I would have finished the race were it not for an urgent work matter, much like the one I'm on now.
Actually, you don't. It is a little known fact among those who police that the Wayfarer Act specifically denies the RCM the authority to demand anyone's operator license. I was just being polite. Even school children know the Wayfarer Act. No need to resort to self-pity, Detective. We can still ask for her passport.
Of course.
The woman is silent, smiling while the waves lap against the hull. In your hand, under the plastic, a light blue passport saying, Republic of Vespa. The coat of arms has a lion and an ostrich. Segent. The woman, born in the year 3 in the commune of Rivershaw, smiles at you. Face adorned with frown lines and crow's feet. The photo is recent. The name reads, Rejoice Leighton Messier.
Yes, but please don't call me that. Joyce is much more efficient. My husband is. I have dual citizenship. A Vespertine is handier when traveling.
She nods and returns the plastic bag to her coat.
Good. What we do? I'm afraid I don't speak for Wild Pines as a whole. It's a giant undertaking. The Pines' core competency is logistics. Container shipping, freight, that sort of thing. See those airships there, linking? Those are the shipping side of things. And that is the terminal. Another subdivision deals with energy, oil and gas exploration, offshore platforms. I'm not at liberty to discuss the company balance sheet, but I can tell you that last year, the company booked more than 20 billion real in revenue.
A billion?
It's a number, officer. A big one. It's made of 1,000 millions. A million is made of 1,000 thousands. Yes, past a certain point, numbers begin to seem imaginary. But they are quite real for the 72,000 employees who depend on Wild Pines for their paychecks. A conglomerate the size of Wild Pines is like a shark. If it stops moving and growing, it will die. Then what becomes of those 72,000 families? It is a tremendous responsibility. They started as an exploration and cargo fleet conducting trade between the Samaran and Insulindian Isolas 250 years ago. When Pine ships explored the South Seminese and charted Lormantang on behalf of the suzerain. Centuries of care, deliberation, and madness have gone into this endeavor. Vessels pass through the great unrest to re-emerge with apricots in tow. The logic of the system is totalizing. It's taken everything from its employees to build it. You mean aside from being the terminal's legal owners? Who are responsible for moving 8% of the world's cargo. We built this district. All the best parts of it. Rue de Saint-Ghislaine, with its bastions. The plazas, Meteor and Mosaic. Even some of the old street lamps have been put back thanks to the investments from the WP. Before Martinez was swallowed by the industrial harbour, even before it was part of Revachol, long before Terminal B was erected here, the Pines built it as a resort for its Revacholian employees. A company getaway, for a weekend or a summer holiday. Then came the revolution. But that's another matter. I'm here to make sure the Pines can fulfill their responsibilities to the place they built.
With your help, hopefully, says her warm tone. I am sorry. It just doesn't come out of your mouth.
Excuse me? I didn't hear you.
What you meant to say was...
Everything. Right up to, but not including, trade secrets. First, you'd have to repeal the Emergencies Act of Trade in Aliments. That gives me the right to silence. It's quite the octopus. Good luck. It's only kept in place by the vested interests of half the civilized world, including your own.
What the man means is that the Emergencies Act and the RCM both get their authority from the coalition government.
But I am derailing us. You wanted to know about the strike. I believe the official title is Senior Labor Negotiator. In practice, I'm a grocery clerk. I relay the union's demands to Wildpines and return with Wildpines' counteroffer.
And how are the talks going?
They're not. That's the problem. The union stopped all negotiations a week ago, after that awful lynching took place. Now they won't even let me into the harbor. There's a 2-meter-20 racist behemoth blocking the gates. What can I say? The union employs a giant covered in tattoos. A racist giant. I guess that's part of their big tent organization now. Let's say I was not making the kind of progress I'd hoped for when I first arrived.
And when did you first arrive?
I arrived 3 weeks ago. Yes, in the middle of February. The bay was still partially frozen then. I prefer to do these things on site, like the RCM.
But the strike began in December.
I wasn't the original negotiator here. I took over after Mr. Gaumont hit a wall with Mr. Clare, the union boss. Mr. Clare refused to speak with Gaumont despite concessions he'd granted the union in prior negotiations.
This isn't the first time the union has gone on strike?
Heavens, no. There have been 2 prior strikes. Both times the union won significant concessions, including overtime pay and a medical plan. This time their demands are more, I guess you could say, aggressive. There are leaflets everywhere and banners. What did they say again? Oh yes, every worker, a member of the board. Then you might also like their other slogan. Demand democracy. Personally, I agree. It lacks the pizzazzo of every worker a member of the board. It's quite simple, you see. Every time the Wild Pines group makes a decision, about what? About anything, really, it needs the signature of each of the 2,200 workers in its Martinez terminal. Just so you understand, this is but one of 22 terminals owned by Wild Pines. Essentially, not only are they kings of the company, they are also kings of the 72,000 employees of Wild Pines Group. That may well be. It's not up to me to decide who is king, but as negotiations go, it's not a swell start. I'm not sure. Naturally, I assume that was just their opening position. A hard-nosed tactic with a side of mockery. But there's been no follow-up, just the same nonsensical slogan repeated over and over again. And now, people are getting lynched, I hear. Behind the whirling in rags. A disastrous situation if there ever was one.
Excuse me, from whom did you hear about this lynching?
I first heard it from the boyer at the gates. The one whose very name advertises his aversion to work. I think he said it was... Call me Manana.
This checks out.
Mr. Clare told him to... How did he put it? Fuck off, midget. Gaumont is short of stature, you see. Yes. Keep in mind, this is a negotiator Mr. Clare has worked with before, and who was more than fair with him and the union. Everard Clare is a man of the utmost integrity. If you can say one thing about him, it's that he always puts the interests of the workers first. Of course not. Everard is fantastically corrupt. I imagine he has a thick, viscous goo where you and I have blood. He is the most corrupt individual I have ever seen, and I deal with men like him for a living. If there is anyone more venal, more irredeemably nepotistic, then it's his twin brother, Edgar.
Yes, Edgar looks exactly like his brother, except for that lazy eye. He also talks exactly like Evrak does. And when one's term as foreman is up, the other takes over. It's how they circumvent the term limits, you see, with a funny little switcheroo. While in office, they've embezzled God knows how much of their workers' dues. The Debardeurs Union was once a perfectly normal institution. 20 years ago, anyway. It must not have been easy to establish under the Emergency Act. But they did it. I can respect that. Organized labor at its best, as they say. Then something happened in the local chapter elections. The brothers Clare came and transformed it into a... how do you say...
a mob. The Debardeurs are a crime syndicate. Sad as it may be, I suspect we'll be forced to cooperate with them.
Refreshingly honest, officer. The company has tried appeasing in the past, but I'm afraid our concessions have only emboldened Evrart and his brother. And your opinion, Detective, if I may ask. I'm a curious and talkative person, you see. Would you say the Debardeurs Union is... why do you think so? Ha! A real man of the left. What else can I tell you about? I'm glad you asked. There was a woman, the previous forewoman of the Union. She disappeared.
Disappeared?
Yes. On the last day of the local chapter elections, her daughter phoned in and said she wasn't running anymore. Or coming to work. Ever. End of story. Downright haunting, if you ask me. The Wild Pines suspected foul play. But what could they do? It was a union matter. The point of the presentation is, these kinds of things happen around the Clares. Watch out when you're dealing with him.
Thank you for your concern, ma'am. We'll be just fine.
Of course. How else can I help? Quite a few things, I'm afraid. The information I'm to share with you includes sensitive trade secrets. For the sake of my employer, I have to ask for your names and badge numbers.
Of course, ma'am. We should have introduced ourselves. I am Lieutenant Kitsuragi, from Precinct 57. And this is my colleague from Precinct 41. I'm afraid he doesn't have his badge at the moment. I hope mine will suffice.
How curious. Why is that, Detective? I see. So, are you saying you lost your badge during the course of this episode? Oh dear. I suppose this does explain some of the more curious turns in our conversation.
As I said, ma'am, his technique may be very unconventional, but he is an officer of the RCM.
Of course, I sympathize, but I'm afraid I simply can't share anything more until I've seen that badge.
Feelings will guide the way.
I assure you, it is no small matter for me either. We all share the responsibility for disarming this situation. I hope you have a badge for me as soon as possible.
She's silent. The wind flaps the sail above her.
Officer. You know, I don't mean to sound cold, but if you want something, you have to give something back. More than just guilt.
You're doing it. Despite your own best efforts, you're still getting in. Somehow.
I'll be frank with you. If I'm going to break protocol, I need to be able to justify it to my superiors. They're going to want to see something tangible. The Union is conducting drug trade out of the harbor. It's an open secret in Martinez. Surely it must not come as a complete surprise to the RCM either. Perhaps it's time to look into it. Or, you can find your badge, which honestly seems like a lost cause.
Detective, a word in private before we continue.
Hey. Psst. Psst. Hey. You. Yes, you. Word on the street is you're ready to start building communism again. You keep saying things like, down with the bourgeoisie, eat the rich, sodomize the landowners, impel all people who have more than 25 real in their pocket. Literally murder all human beings, regardless of their political beliefs. That kind of stuff. Funky style. Very funky. So tell me, do you have any questions before we fire up the big communism builder? Or do we get right down to it? Oh yeah, get the firing squads and the animal wagons ready. Too late to back out now. You can't make an omelet without breaking a few million eggs.
This is not going quite as I hoped it would, Detective. Honestly, I was expecting you to use your unorthodox technique to keep her off balance, and you know, not volunteers to be her henchmen. This woman is running circles around us. She might have known about your misplaced badge all along, or she's simply an adept improviser. Either way, we've played straight into her hands. No. If there is reasonable suspicion, we must investigate. Otherwise, she could claim we are siding with the Union, or that we are on their take. We'd never hear the end of it. What I propose is, we ask her, then we investigate, briefly. But do not share the outcome of this investigation with her. We tell her it's done and demand for her information on the lynching. Oh, that would be fantastic, but do we have the time? The world is large and your badge is 8x6 centimeters. You could request a new one from your station, but that would literally take months.
You're back. Good. What can I help you with?
Voila! You're doing it. Really put your back into it. Yell it from the top of your lungs.
Why, yes, I am rich. How much money do you need? Hopefully not too much. I couldn't bring all of it with me.
She's surprisingly nonchalant about this. If anything, you're finally asking it has relieved some of the tension.
That's a good sum. Not too small, not fantastically large.
She removes a few notes and hands them to you. The paper is cold and oily to the touch.
So, I hope I didn't just bribe you, officer. It may not be technically illegal under the Emergency Act, but still.
You're right, ma'am, that donations are permitted under the Emergency Act, unseemly as it may be, as long as they're properly logged with the precinct.
Which he most certainly will do. Now, how else can I help the RCM today? Besides supplementing its salaries. It's quite straightforward. Someone is using Terminal B to smuggle raw ingredients from the Samaran Isola into Revachol, with the Union's blessing. Wild Pines has suspected it for years.
Ingredients for what, ma'am?
Meth and dextroamphetamine, GBL and various synthetic psychedelics. Honestly, it might be quicker to say what you can't make from the stuff. Yes. After they clear the terminal, we lose track. The actual production is taking place at various sites in and around Jamrock Quarter, north of here.
Wild Pine seems to be well apprised of the local drug trade, ma'am. Do you mean to say the Union also produces the product? Sells drugs, I mean?
We're in logistics. It's our business to know. And no. As far as the company knows, the Union does not produce it. They transport the ingredients for a cut. Yes, but you won't get anything out of Evrart and the Dock Workers Union. Still, every chain has its weak link. The lorries. Someone needs to move the ingredients from the harbour into the city. Once they reach Jamrock, they're distributed to a network of local manufacturers, well beyond our grasp. But in transit, they are vulnerable. Perhaps you've noticed that a number of lorries are tangled in a traffic jam at the roundabout just now. Interview the drivers who are still hanging about. One of them might be waiting for a crucial shipment. I'll be explicit. If you find this driver, I will share company secrets with you. We did. On more than one occasion. Apparently, there's some sort of inter-precinct disagreement about whose jurisdiction this area falls under.
We know the company has launched its own probe into the Union's alleged involvement. We also know it's come up empty. It's not just the RCM. No one's been able to find any hard evidence.
Well, here's your chance, officers. No. We asked East Motor Track to raise the drawbridge. The road company is a partner of one of our subsidiaries. However, this is a limited time opportunity. Once the complaint has been processed by the Trade Committee, they'll have no choice but to lower the drawbridge, and the operation will continue. Thousands of liters of raw ingredients will pour onto the streets of Revachol. Not the east across the river, but the west. The vulnerable. The weary.
A cold breath rushes in from the bay, making its way down the alleyways and potholed streets. From Martinez to Jamrock, in the traffic you hear the clinking of glass vials concealed beneath tarpaulin. Or is it just your teeth chattering in the cold?
A lot of it. It comes in from large Samaran factories in South Safrey, Sigai, and Sinyal. The literage they must get from this terminal alone must be oceanic.
Well, at least this solves one mystery.
What is that, Lieutenant?
Why I had to call East Motor Tract and beg them to open a drawbridge for me. I'd wander since I first drove in, on my motor carriage.
I am sorry for the inconvenience, Lieutenant Kisaragi. But we need them trapped here. This is a unique opportunity. I'm sure you understand. How do you think they're financing this strike? There are thousands of unpaid dock workers going strong for the fourth month straight.
There was a shakedown of local businesses preceding the strike. Many were squeezed to bankruptcy to fund it.
With all due respect to these desert cacti, the contents of a few cash registers cannot provide for 2,000 men. The local businesses can scarcely provide for themselves. Precisely. Smuggled out of that very gate at night, most likely, then loaded onto lorries and driven to Jamrock. You simply need to find one driver who will open up to you. Yes? Excellent. According to my reports, there are at least 3 lorry drivers lingering near the roundabout. Hopefully one of them will know something. It may come to nothing, or it may just blow the case wide open. I can keep the drawbridge up for a few more days at least. You should have the time you need. In the meantime, let me know if there's any other way I may be of assistance. This reality. Ah, yes. The episode. Sounds like an acute case of encephalopathy, now that I think of it.
Don't be fazed, madame. He functions perfectly well. He only needs a low down on all of reality.
We may be here a while, then. Ask away, officer. I'll help however I can.
All right. We're in. I know these all look good, but begin with the first, okay?
We're in Martinez, baby. A casual term of endearment popular among the 50-plus crowd. It's a disco holdover, pay it no heed. Aren't we all? Martinez is a district of Revachol. A very small district tucked away near the industrial harbour. North of the 881 and Jamrock. You would be excused for not knowing about it. Unimportant, they say. Forgotten, even. Shelled to smithereens during the revolution. It has its charms, just not this time of year. I'm not a good ambassador. I've only been here once before, as a teenager. Not a lot has changed. There are ruins, a terminal, fishing boats, reeds, boys with boxy shoulders. As I told you, Martinez used to be a province, a workers' resort before the city swallowed it and the artillery did its part. Now the reeds are the real star of the show here. The further down the coast, the wilder it gets. It's not really a sea, it's the Bay of Revachol. And the bay feeds into the ocean. Yes, we're on an island in an ocean, the world's largest body of water, the Insulindic.
Vast, lukewarm, and unknowable, flowing in and out of sight.
Caillou, as you already know. Imagine a pebble. A smoothed-over pebble amidst a great blue sea, misshapen, cracked. The cracks are the River Esperance. We're in the delta of this river on the sixth branch, the Martinez distributary.
It is clear this pebble is of enormous value to her.
Revachol? Revachol is what you call a city, the great kind.
As if it's self-explanatory, beyond patriotism, a fact.
History, detective. They built this city to resolve history. Our part in it, at least. Our centuries. The nations of the Occident, or migrant workers from Seminine and Ile Marat, depending on your creed. In the DeLorean century. 380 years ago. They say it's where the terrible questions of our time will be answered. The tensions are highest, the fault lines deepest. By that I mean, conflicts. Ideological conflicts. The stuff of men. We are standing on a fertile, self-sufficient island able to sustain up to 200 million people in the middle of the Insulindic Ocean, the world's connective tissue. It's where the money is. I think it's fair to say so. Martinez is about 22 kilometers from the center of the world. That soldering iron is the Bank of the World building. The bottom floors are Insiacom. Coalition government, Insulindian Mission Command.
Silence. The water, the light. It's as though you're seeing it for the first time. There is no recognition. Only the immensity of the sea and the cold radiating from it. She observes your eyes scanning the horizon. Then breaks the silence, slowly. This is one thought you need to complete. Where are you?
Was there something else you wanted to know? I remember something about a lowdown.
This has been informative. Thank you, ma'am. I'm sure my memory-impaired partner has many more questions to ask, about even more fundamental aspects of reality. Might I suggest not asking them all right now? Ma'am, Messier will be here later too, and tomorrow. Isn't that true, ma'am?
Absolutely. My commitment here is long-term.
Oh, of course not. You are already diligent for getting this far. And diligent boys remember where they left off.
Indeed. I'm always at your service. Glad to have been of assistance. The little that I know. Anything else? Of course, detective.
Yeah, you better keep walking. Look at me when I'm talking to you.
Welcome to Crime, Romance, and Biographies of Famous People. My name is Plaisance. Be welcome, and please take responsibility for the energy you bring into this space. Sir, don't be ridiculous. I certainly will not give you money. I would be doing you a grave psychic disfavor. One has to earn one's success, even if one is a police officer. Handouts are nothing but manipulation. All they do is make you dependent.
Son, you got destroyed there. What an idiot you are.
I am the proudest owner of our little shop of culture. Then why are you talking to me? Everything is on the shelves to browse. Don't you feel compelled to buy anything? See those shelves there? Go, be drawn. Everything is on the shelves. Take a look yourself. The shelves compel you, don't they?
She smiles and nods, seemingly relieved.
Cursed? Who said that? Annette? I will have a word with her. This place is not cursed. It has a robustly magnetic energy. Good for commercial activity. My business is thriving, sir. Annette, yes, my daughter. I hope she wasn't slacking off again with her nose in science fiction. Tell me, was she at her post doing her job like a proper girl? Wonderful. Did you talk to her? Great. On a scale of 1 to 10, how compelled were you to buy books after talking with her? Come now, it's not personal. It's about proper sales practices and market research. I expect an answer. My precious, her dedication brings joy to my heart. If you have children, I hope they turn out as great as my Annette. You must be kidding. There's nothing like that happening. Good, sir. What does a young child do with money anyway? No, I save it for her, as a fund. She's securing her financial future out there. Indeed. Are we done with the jokes now?
Yes, we've had quite enough fun here. Right.
God! Ugh! I've told her not to do that. It's such a disgusting habit. She'll get over it. Anxiety is a part of life. She can, if she has enough willpower. This is what's called growing pains. Life isn't easy. Life doesn't give breaks.
Come on, ma'am. It's obvious she can't do anything about it. You are placing an unnecessary burden on a young child.
She stands stiff and severe, silently fuming. 10 or so seconds pass without change.
Oh, no. Hold on. I need to invite her inside and apologize. She must be freezing out there. There. I don't know what to say to you. My husband, he tries to teach me business lessons. I have what my mother called a dull mind. All this stress. Yes, my husband is a successful entrepreneur east of the river. If only he were more involved in the business we're running up here. No matter. Soon we'll both be off for Grand Caron. It's a proper place to live. One of the most peaceful neighbourhoods east of Jamrock. You may know it for its massive housing projects. Most of the buildings are empty at the moment. It's a great opportunity to get ahead of the crowds. Better times ahead for sure. He made the initial investment. Since then, he's been what you might call a silent partner. Yes, I'm afraid so. A real treat she is. It would be nice if she had... No, we couldn't have afforded more children, really. Not in this economy.
A glimmer of sadness blinks through the well-crafted exterior.
We're quite busy people, you know, my husband and I. Quite busy. Children are a lot of work. You don't look like a father, so I don't expect you to understand. I'm sorry. I'm sure you do understand. She's been too busy helping me here. So she studied at home this trimester. This is a temporary solution, of course. I assure you, I of all people understand the importance of education. She will be back in school the moment the store takes off.
The woman looks aloof. Her features much softer. Occasionally she glances at her daughter's silhouette.
I'm sorry, sir. I can't talk right now. I'm very busy with my homework. I have so much homework now.
You just can't win. Out of the rain and into the gutter. You have absolutely no idea. Familiar? How? You must have forgotten something you heard again.
Math. It's really difficult. Like, really. They say you need it to get rich. Better than standing outside in the cold, I guess. Oh, I found something while you were away. I thought this would fit you. Like, thanks for helping out. Not me. The city, I mean. Like a detective does. Yes, just like the one Dick Mullen wears all the time. You'll look way more serious with that. Right, I have to get back to my homework now. Before Mum notices. Man, this is hard.
The display rack is brimming with worn paperbacks featuring an extremely muscular, sword-wielding barbarian on the cover. Nearly all the titles contain the word Heimdall somewhere. Rows and rows of Heimdallar men blur your vision. You make out some titles. Man from Heimdall and the Mammoth Riders. Man from Heimdall, Return to Heimdall. And the solipsistic Man from Heimdall and the Heimdall Man. Maybe 100? Man from Heimdall and the Sages at the End of the World. Man from Heimdall and the False God. Man from Heimdall and the Scorched Earth. Man from Heimdall, the Heimdall Colonies. Man from Heimdall and the Swamp Beast. Man from Heimdall and the Snow Crabs. Those snow crabs are worse than they sound. Not even close. Man from Heimdall in hell. Man from Heimdall and the forest of slaves. Man from Heimdall under the lake. Man from Heimdall, Heimdall burning. There's even the Trial of Death, a pastoral combat gamebook set in the world of Heimdallar Man. And so much more. A twinge at the back of your head makes you flinch. Your eye starts twitching. Your hand reaches toward a book with glossy cover art of the very muscular Man from Heimdall in chains, kneeling in front of a staircase leading to a throne. A woman sits on the throne, leering at the man. She's laughing at him, belittling him. Between the throne and the Heimdallar Man lies a bonfire, casting shadows on the wall. The shadow of the woman's headdress looks like a pair of devil horns. The title reads, Man from Heimdall and the Devil Woman. The display rack before you is burdened under piles of Man from Heimdall novels.
It is a bestseller for a reason.
You've acquired an interactable item. Investigate this item further by going to the Interact tab in your inventory.
The edges of the pages are worn and smudged. A lot of people have read about the Devil Woman's altercations with the Heimdall Man. The jacket copy proclaims, "Man from Heimdall returns in his most exciting adventure yet. After crashing into a strange jungle, cannibalistic natives abduct his only surviving comrade, Noble Tiribald. Before Man from Heimdall can mount a rescue, he is ambushed by a tribe of female warriors and taken to the ancient citadel of Cloud City, where a mysterious and wicked queen rules supreme. Will Man from Heimdall be able to escape his dire situation and find his missing friend?" You open the book to a random page. Man from Heimdall, wielding his two Zweihanders, is carving through a sea of savages, his visage fixed in grim determination. His arms whirling like windmills are soaked with the blood of his enemies. Mangled corpses litter the battlefield. You flip to the copyright page. This book was written in 38. Berserker rage burns in his azure-hued eyes as he brings glory and honor to his long-lost Heimdallr tribe from the village of Heimdall. The ivory giant roars like an ice bear, and the winds of Gatla howl out his name. Man from Heimdall rides on a gilded griffin, his golden mane billowing in the breeze. Both Zweihanders sheathed on his back. He is off to war. Will he conquer his enemies? Will he conquer himself? The steel muscles of Man from Heimdall gleam in the humid jungle air. Yet the man does not sweat. In meditation, his soul drifts in the frigid northlands he calls home. A passage reads, "The man from Heimdall looks up, his eyes blue as the mountain lakes of his homeland. He rarely speaks, but now his voice booms in the darkened throne room. Do not try to sap my masculine essence, wicked temptress. Son of Heimdall will never succumb to your seductive wiles. Thine spells are no match for purity and strength of will. Brothers of Heimdall, stand above the vices of flesh, for it is weak and corruptible, yet mine is forged in gore and strife." Queen Lidiana just laughs, a sultry and salacious sound, then says, "I have grand plans for you, man from Heimdall." She gestures her diabolical hand toward an array of potions and unguents. "First, you shall please me. Then, lead my armies against the vicious cannibals." Not a muscle moves in the face of the man from Heimdall. Yet inside, there is turmoil. This goes against all he holds sacrosanct. In the final pages, Man from Heimdall mounts Galavarin, his mighty griffin, and turns his gaze to the horizon. Queen Lidiana is dead, but an army of cannibals is storming the gates, and still there's no word of trusty Tiribald. To find out what happens next, you'll have to pick up Man from Heimdall and the Three-Eyed Skull, available in fine bookstores everywhere, Spring 39. A small mountain of colorful board game boxes. There are numerous types of games for all ages. A lot of shelf space seems to be taken up by Wirral-related merchandise. An endless variety of sourcebooks, lore books, and codices litter the table. The topmost book is titled Welkin Compendium, 2nd edition. There's also a large hardbound tome with intricate cover art, The Hunters of Catawak, Boreal Creature Compendium, and a pick-your-path adventure gamebook titled Tales of Wirral, Cavern of Velkrag. There's a box that says Wirral, 3rd Edition Mega Setting Supplements Module. The side panel notes, a fantastique adventure board game, new maps and miniatures. A sticker on it displays 25 Rial. Nonsense for anemic Beano clods. Thank you. These shelves are overburdened with books from the same series. You see the name Dick Mullen over and over. A couple of spook novels hide amidst all the detective books. Thrilling tales of spycraft and derring do. Crime fiction is a disgrace. An asinine misrepresentation of the physical attributes of the arduous everyday work of actual police officers. These books greatly overstate the excitement of police work, glossing over how long it takes to actually follow up on leads and eliminate dead ends. What's more, they completely ignore the psychological hardships of year after year coming into contact with people during the worst days of their lives. Not a single mention of all the stress this work creates upon the officer's family. Detective fiction just doesn't tell the truth at all. Now, would you like a list of all the books found on the shelf? You see, Dick Mullen on the job. Get Me Mullen. The Stalwart Adventures of Richard P. Mullen. Dick Mullen and the Murder in the Orchard. The Sordid Affair of Dick Mullen. A Killing is Declared. Dick Mullen in the Murder House. The Final Case of Dick Mullen. An Obvious Lie. Dick Mullen in the Clock Tower. The Ordeals of Dick Mullen. Dauntless Dick. Dick Mullen's Funeral Pyre. The Murder of Dick Mullen. Oh no, turns out he faked it to solve a case. Yes, there's also The Dame Who Did It. Farewell, My Mullen. Faking death seems to be a common trope in the Mullen series. The Morbid Tales of Dick Mullen. A Dark Tide Turns. Tragedy Calls for Dick Mullen. Another one with fake death. And, of course, Dick Mullen, the murderer. In order to catch a murderer, Dick Mullen must become the murderer. After all this, you still haven't found the answer to the one question that matters. Who is Dick Mullen? Your quick eye notices a small caterpillar crawling across the spine of a book. The title reads, Dick Mullen and the Mistaken Identity. A worn paperback from Dick Mullen's classic Hard-Boiled Phase. The premise seems to be that Dick Mullen is framed for the murder of his best friend and has just a few days to prove his innocence. Could it be the motifs of unstable identities and shocking betrayals? Then this is the book for you.
Of course. Such violence and immorality. Enjoy.
In your hand, you hold Dick Mullen and the Mistaken Identity. The brittle paperback feels fragile to the touch. The cover features a pastiche of different scenes. In the foreground, a man in a dark overcoat clutches a pistol to his chest. Rising up behind him are two silhouettes wrapped in a passionate embrace. The tagline reads, Detective Dick Mullen must prove his innocence after an old friend is murdered by someone who looks just like Dick Mullen. That, needless to say, it violates nearly every RCM regulation for a detective to investigate a murder in which he is a suspect.
Are you really reading that, Detective? Good luck finding it. He's not much of a character, I think you'll find. Just a stand-in for the reader.
The story opens with a knock at the door. Detective Dick Mullen is greeted by an old friend, Charlie Spillane, who's come to Mullen to ask a favor on this dark and cold night. Spillane needs Mullen to drive him in from Vespa to a small town along the Insulindian coast. Despite his friend's apparent agitation, Mullen does as he's asked, then returns home where he passes out drunk, as he does most nights. An extremely unprofessional and hurtful stereotype that's offensive to all upstanding officers of the law. But also extremely accurate in your case. Give it time. You'll fall off the wagon sooner or later. 2 days later, Mullen is arrested by the Vespa police and charged with the murder of Charlie Spillane. At his interrogation, Mullen learns that Charlie Spillane was shot in a bar in the very town Mullen dropped him off in by a man matching Mullen's description. Desperate to clear his name, Mullen manages to convince the Vesper police to release him for 3 days so that Mullen may solve his friend's murder and prove his innocence.
What's the matter, detective?
The lieutenant shrugs, resigned to the idea that his profession will rarely, if ever, be accurately represented in art and literature. They're not shitting you, detective. This is what the writers think passes for police procedure. Of course, Mullen didn't do it. That's the whole premise of the book. Anyway, Mullen returns to the seaside bar where Spillane was murdered and meets a beautiful, mysterious woman named Diana Deneuve. Deneuve reveals that she was Spillane's lover and that he was mixed up with a local amphetamine smuggling operation. As soon as Mullen begins pulling at strings, the whole conspiracy begins to unravel. Not only is the local police captain in on the amphetamine ring, so is the son of a powerful politician and a strung-out art collector named Torvald, each of whom has his own reasons for wanting Spillane dead. Outwardly, the old police captain is a real law and order crypto-fascist, a barrel-chested man who's beaten his share of suspects to pulp. But he's also dirty and increasingly paranoid that someone's going to expose his role in the drug ring. He would certainly have the motive and the means, but the captain walks with a noticeable limp from an old war injury. Is it possible that he was able to conceal it long enough to commit the murder? A typical privileged twat. In all likelihood, he's just in over his head. He does bear a personal grudge against Belaine, though. A former prosecutor who nearly brought down his father's administration. The kid doesn't exactly have Dick Mullen's manly build, but he is the correct height. And while interrogating him at his home, Mullen did notice a certain overcoat that looks suspiciously like his own. Torvald, the art collector, is a strung-out mess. Frankly, it's hard to imagine him holding a pistol steady enough to actually hit someone, let alone plug them 3 times in the chest the way Spillane got did. That said, Torvald and Spillane have a long history. And while interrogating him, Mullen discovers that Torvald was once involved with Diana Deneuve. Could it be that this is all over a sordid love triangle? One evening, Diana Deneuve comes to Mullen's hostel room in tears. The two of them drink half a bottle of vodka, and soon they're seeking comfort in each other's arms. Yes, comfort and pleasure. The warmth of another human's touch. The burning taste of liquor on her full, sweet lips. Well, that testimony won't be admissible any longer. The man's a prosecutor's nightmare. Solving a murder counts for nothing if all the evidence gets thrown out in court over police misconduct. As the two lovers share a post-coital cigarette, Diana Deneuve turns to Mullen and says, "By the way, Dick, there was something else I meant to tell you. I love you." The name of the true killer. Whatever it is, Mullen never hears the words. A blow to the base of his skull knocks him out cold instantly. When Mullen comes to, Deneuve is dead on the hostel bed next to him. To make matters worse, his clothes are covered with her blood. Mullen trashes his blood-stained clothes and flees the hostel, knowing it's only a matter of hours before the cops discover Deneuve's body, if they haven't been tipped off already. Fleeing a crime scene, destroying evidence. Even if Detective Mullen didn't commit the murder, he should be facing years behind bars. The heat is on. If Dick Mullen can't solve both murders before the cops catch up to him, he's going away for life. Can you solve the case before the cops close in? What is it, Detective? There was never a time when he wasn't a detective. He was born a detective. For a moment, you cease to read the story on the page and see the book for what it is. A collection of brittle, cheaply printed pages held together by glue made from the hooves of horses. From nowhere, you hear the screech of sneakers on a waxed floor, and you feel the burn of rope against your hands. Are these figments of some other life? You won't find the answers you're looking for here, in other words. It's a dangerous line of work, but somebody has to do it. That's why Dick Mullen never lets anyone get too close. What's the matter? Afraid you've been hacking up your friends' bodies in the night? Have you gone over everyone? Is anybody missing? Is it really so evil, Detective? Then why are you still here? Just make sure you don't lose him. You'll not find another like him. It's true, in more ways than you know. But then, what does this book know? It's just a poorly made piece of pulp garbage, made to be consumed and discarded. So, who did it, Detective? Who killed Charlie Spillane and Deanna Deneuve? Could be. Who knows? Only one way to find out. You begin furiously flipping through pages. Even as you know these books follow a series of well-worn tropes, you find yourself completely engrossed. You're turning pages so fast, you don't even notice the ancient spine coming unglued. You try to grab the pages as they come loose, but your fingers aren't quick enough. They're gone. Dozens of pages scatter across the floor. The last fifth or so of the book seems to have been lost. It's possible that you could gather and reassemble the pages, but it would take way too long.
Ah, yes. The problem with mass-market paperbacks. They are not made to last. Perhaps this is a sign that you should get back to solving your own murder, huh, Detective?
Don't forget, it could have been the delirium tremens. In your hand, you hold four-fifths of Dick Mullen and the mistaken identity. Jamais vu. Derealization. Jamais vu. The opposite of déjà vu. Not already seen, but never seen. Everything that should be familiar appears strange and new, like some half-forgotten day in your childhood. Only now. That's the feeling you've been having. And for who knows how long. You should go and ask Joyce Messier about this. What world are we in? This is a fundamental question. The shelf reads, Biographies of Famous People. You see a large variety of names, none of which ring a bell. Browsing through all the books with all their names makes your head spin. None of these seem important or relevant. It's all just vapid egoism. Suddenly, a particularly odd title catches your eye. It reads, High Speed Love, The Tragic True Love Story of Jacob Irv and Alfie Delatraz. By one Cecilia Averbrook. High Speed Love chronicles the romance between two of the finest tip-top tournée racers in history. One of them is the madcap driver, Jacob Irv. His blonde mane graces the cover. Next to Irv's life story, you see a slim biography of an Occidental rock star called the Antistar. He's famous for shooting morphine into one of his eyeballs and cocaine into the other. Next to that, Rivershalian radio personality Guillaume Bevy stands in front of a rundown drug den. He's a permanent fixture on Channel 8, reporting on real-life crime and ruining cops' days.
I really must insist you buy one of the books. Reading them is not for free. Do still browse, though, but not too long. I'm sorry, I did not mean to rush you. You are browsing. Go ahead, take your time. Time is commerce.
Several maps have been attached to a bulletin board hidden inside the alcove. They're held up by small pins. The board has come loose from one corner. The maps look old and faded, your eye catches a map of Insulinda, a map of Revachol, and a map of Martinez. This large map displays archipelagos. You see a constellation of small dots on the light blue emptiness of the Insulindic Ocean. The largest in the northeast is La Caillou. You are here. Another, far away in the southwest, Seminese Islands, Île de Fantôme, Ozon, Laurentide, Fas Alamir, Archipelagos, North Arcade Islands, all just specks of dust on the vastness of the Insulindic. On the edges of the map, the color fades into a blur of dotted lines, black and white. In the northeast, a dust mite stands on the north coast of Caillou, in a bookstore. It's you. Radiating outwards from you, the suzerain Revachol. With a radius of 80 kilometers, still, the crown jewel of this Isola would be barely visible. You can, on Caillou, Revachol, a single black star, on Ozon, Fondelier, and Vimandou, on archipelagos, Croyan Moran, Villiers, on Seminine, Olduvai, and on Laurentide, Deora of the Seven Seas. The ocean breaks apart into a tangle of cosines and azimuths, all pointing into pale nothingness. Mwindi is the north azimuth. Grad is the northeast azimuth. Samara is the east azimuth. Seol is the west azimuth. Isolas, they're called. Connections to other worlds. Words past the Insulindian, unknown to you. You only know you've never been there. You have little idea what they are. Distant stars. Gods. But looking at them makes you feel almost non-existent. Whatever they are, the Isolas are immeasurably large compared to you. And very, very far away. Perhaps they are gods. Gods of distance and outer dust. The north coast of a verdant island is shattered by the delta of a river. It is the River Esperance. Countless bridges put the shards back together, connecting city blocks to river islands. La Delta says a great artificial heart in the center, teeming with life forms and construction. To the east, rolling hillsides, Le Jardin, Stella Marie, the suburbs of Saint-Baptiste, swallowed up into the megacity. They sound rich to you. This is Revachol East. Houdon, it's somewhere to live. Not bad. Then there's Jamrock. It's bad. People shouldn't live there, but they do. Then Forberg. It's almost as bad, and much larger. Then Coal City. It's the worst. You feel you're just west of Coal City. Somewhere above Jamrock and close to Coal City. It's not really a map. It's a tourist thing. A picture postcard with buildings on it, drawn from an isometric perspective. A date in the upper right corner says 48. Still, it's detailed. Could be pretty useful for scouting ahead. You see the jagged boxes of an industrial harbor, even the whirling in rags there. You see a set of tattered curtains blocking the way to another room. A strange cage-like trinket dangles from the curtains.
Excuse me, officer. The back room is strictly for employees only. Nothing. Now please go back to browsing the books. Don't you feel compelled to look at the books? The books are all you care about.
Oddly enough, the more she tries to draw you away from the curtains, the more alluring they become. You see some kind of charm. An irregular polyhedron assembled from bones, sticks, and straw. Inside, a disturbing fish head with empty eye sockets stares at you. Aside from poking at it suspiciously, there is nothing else to do with the fish head charm at this time. The curtains remain shut before you. Just as you're about to pull apart the curtains, the petrified voice of the shop owner cries out once more.
Sir, don't touch that! I told you it's off limits for the customers. Parapsychologically speaking, we're done if you decide to open them. I won't be held responsible for the consequences. It's too dangerous.
She looks away, mumbling. Why is everyone always messing with the curtains? Why can't they just buy books like normal people?
No, it's just a storeroom for the employees, I told you. Now please step away from the curtains. You do? My God, even more reasons not to mess with the curtains. Just step away, dear sir. No! Please just talk to me, officer. Come here and let's talk this through before you decide to do anything extreme.
Lies. Rip them open, we say. There is something mysterious about the curtains. Be careful. The curtains, tattered with age and covered in dust, hang before you, as if taunting you. You see a dimly lit room full of dusty furniture and trash. A doorway stands in the back, covered in dozens of scary little cage-like trinkets, your shadow looming over it like an omen.
I warned you, you're unleashing forces beyond your understanding.
A heavy door with a missing handle stands before you, covered in dozens, if not hundreds, of little oddly shaped trinkets and charms. It appears to be locked. What if you just break it down? That's right. Take in your surroundings. You need to have a solid ground and a proper posture if you want to succeed. Steady breathing. Solid core. You've got this. With one shoulder forward, you're ready to smash into the door like a battering ram. The room is dimly lit and littered with old barbershop rubbish, but the path to the door is clear. It's made of a solid block of wood, but it has stood there for ages. The hinges are old and coated with a carmine layer of rust. It should be doable. You smash into the wood and see a small crack appear on the doorframe. It's going to take one more try to break through to the other side. But you've done it.
You're not thinking of trying again, are you? What is this place? Yes, but no one's been here in ages. I doubt the electricity still works. We should find a flashlight if we want to go on. There should be one in my kinema.
Some specks of dust shimmer in a faint beam of daylight falling from the window. Other than that, the room is dark. An eerie feeling rises in your chest.
Yes, because it's closed. No need to look for supernatural explanations where a banal one will do. Now, let's go get the flashlight, shall we?
Before you stands a motor carriage. The bodywork is covered in blue and white livery, bearing the number 57. This must be the infernal machine that Tui from Oblivion. In the cabin, you are welcomed by a set of steering levers, a radio microphone on a hook, a pull-out toolbox under the seat, and the soft glow of the fuel preheater gauge. A scent of leatherwork and heavy fuel oils washes over you. A metallic drawer slides out from under the seat and clicks into place. The tools inside are neatly organized.
Take what you need, officer. It's going to be a long case. I'm not protective of my tools, like some men are.
He's clearly a little protective of his tools. But what can you do? Work is work. The pry bar feels nice and cold in your hand, heavier than you'd think. Cold and heavy, like truth. You feel like you're reunited with truth once more. Useful for opening all sorts of doors and lids. The handles are long and sleek. Snap, snap, go the cutters in your hand. You can do good work with these. Cut chains, locks, and ropes, especially belts. It's robust, weatherproof, and well-made. Police issue, blue, lets you see things in the dark you would otherwise miss. The pull-out toolbox slides back into its nest. Preheater gauge casts a warm glow on the steering levers and the radio on its hook. The frequency tableau lights up and a green button labeled Prime Line glows like a feline eye. And then you hear something. The soft purr of electrical kittens. Radio waves cast far and wide over the metropolis. A woman's voice greets you through the static.
This is Precinct 57. Hello, Lieutenant. How may I assist you?
Hello, Alice. Please assist our colleague from the 41st Precinct here. I'm putting him on.
Operating the radio is easy. Just be confident. You've probably done it 1,000 times.
This is Officer Alice Demetri, Precinct 57. How may I assist you?
Under the green prime line, a yellow saved button catches your eye. You wonder what the lieutenant's default radio station is.
As always, it's DJ Mesh and Fellatio, and you're listening to Street Freaks FM, bringing you the hottest, the nastiest, the most vulgar.
A flock of seagulls takes off nearby, startled by the roaring radio. Right away, the lieutenant reaches into the cabin and turns off the radio. He's not looking at you, as he says.
Someone must have been messing with the radio, or maybe picked up a random frequency. You wanted a prime line, right?
This is Precinct 57. How may I assist you? Just a second, officer.
10-2, 10-5. This is 41st. Come in, over.
A scrawny old man sits in a dusty cubicle, smoking, with a large white rectangle sewn on his vest. In front of him is a box-shaped apparatus with an array of wires and antennas. The radio switchboard.
10-4, what's your status? Over. 10-18, 10-20, over. State your message, sir. Over. 10-4, I hear you. I don't have the authority to grant your request, but...
Is it him? What does he want?
He says he needs money.
Don't give that asshole anything. He's just gonna drink it all.
Right. That's a negative on the additional funds, sir. Over. He says he's in trouble. Doesn't have a place to sleep.
Well, I guess he'd better crack the case before sundown, then.
Vigmar said... He says it's important to the...
He isn't getting a red cent. You can tell him that.
Request denied, sir. Over.
Nothing is working.
Anything else, sir? Over. 10-9, repeat message. Over. Then for message received. This is a very serious situation. I need to 1022 the captain. Over.
1022 the captain? This sounds bad. Bad and scary. Like being called to the headmaster's office in school.
Any other good news?
He's saying he lost his badge.
He what? He lost his badge?
Who lost his badge?
Dick fucking Mullen. Who do you think?
It's Officer Dick Mullen from the bestseller Dick Mullen and the Lost Identity.
Dick Mullen is not your name. It's the name of a fictional detective who would not lose his badge. Defend yourself. Immediately. They're laughing at you.
10-4, I hear you, officer. I'm just going to make a note here that you're in pursuit of your misplaced badge. Over.
Fuck me! Mac, come here! You've got to hear this! Dick Mullen lost his badge!
What's going on?
Supercop here lost his badge.
He lost his what now?
His badge. He lost his goddamn fucking badge.
10-9, come again. I didn't get that. Over.
New heights even for Captain Sober.
Ask him. Ask him if he's lost his gun, too.
Sergeant Orson wants to know if you lost your gun, too. Over.
Check your pockets. Check your... Holy fuck. You don't know where it is, do you? Okay, it's gone. Your gun is most definitely gone.
10-9, come in, officer. Did you get my question? We were wondering about your gun. Over. 10-1, you're breaking up. 10-9, repeat, please. Over.
Everything gets scrambled in your brain.
He says he didn't lose his gun. Or...
Ask him to describe it. His gun. Not his fun. Just a gun will do.
Satellite Officer McLean requests a description of your weapon. Over.
The fuck do you need a gun for? Look at the pythons on your arms. You are a gun. The biggest one in the world. Oh, request a description, huh? We'll give him one. Describe the plasma gun.
He says it's just a regular gun.
Sounds like he's being deliberately vague.
Detective Mullen has done it again.
Where's my gun?
Dear God, he lost his gun? Oh my, I can't.
This isn't really a laughing matter.
Mac can face a giant of Coco Noor by himself, but Disco here made him piss his pants.
I can't. Fuck. He lost his... Ask him if he still got his wiener.
I'm not going to.
Ask him.
Sergeant Orson here is wondering if you are still in possession of your genitalia. Over.
Now is a good time to say fuck and ass and so on. That'll make this all right.
That's a negative. Not going to say that. Over.
What's he saying? Share with the class.
He said he sodomized your mother.
The prick ate Mama's vanilla waffles at the captain's birthday party. Some nerve he's got.
Sure her vanilla waffles were the only thing he ate?
Shut up, Chester. This isn't funny. This is my mom we're talking about. Tell him to apologize right now.
Sergeant Orson requests that you apologize for the claims that you made about his mother. Over. Mac, he says you shouldn't have antagonized the Firewalker in the first place.
Who?
Satellite Officer V. I'm afraid he might be referring to himself as Firewater, sir.
Firewater? He's lost it. Fuck it, tell him to find his goddamn badge and gun. That's the only thing that matters.
Satellite Officer V. 10-4, affirmative. Officer is in pursuit of his firearm.
Oh, God, I...
Officer, do you need further assistance? Over. Roger that. 10-10. Over and out.
around you, rain falls on the great city of Rivershaw. Rain drips from the eaves and floods the gutters, washing the filth away. The spring thaw must be here. The snow is melting. Looking up at the sky, cold water dripping from your hat. Gray sky like great battleships, clouds colliding with one another. Rain falls down on the world. Your shirt sticks to your chest. The shoulders of your disco blazer grow heavy. The cold finds its way in under your skin. You shiver, and the city shivers with you. You're not dressed for this weather. You should get an overcoat or a patrol cloak. A traffic jam. Rain thrumming on the roofs of motor vehicles. Inside, drivers watch water streaming down their windshields. The statue of a king shudders. He too is cold. The canal bridge has been raised. The road ascends. A raised motorway loops above the ghetto. Beneath its concrete columns, a sea of rooftops, woodwork, and tar stretches northward. Four-story buildings as far as the rain can fall. The snows melt in Jamrock. Rivershaw is the capital of the world. Jamrock is the capital of Rivershaw. Droplets form on your eyelashes. It's home. To be in Martinez, where no one goes, at the runoff point of a long-forgotten canal, in the whitest part of town, in the shadow of the day the revolution failed. Standing in the rain, looking north, where Jamrock Rock City stretches inland. In the rain-swept distance, above the rooftops of Jamrock, a repurposed silk mill stands perched above the motorway exit. Precinct 41 hunches in the rain. Your vision blurs. You wipe your face with your hand. The rain stings your eyes, making you look up and blink. Sheets of rain over the water. A flight of stairs leading into the ocean. Wave after wave washing the coast of Martinez, with its motorboats and gently swaying reeds. The ruins of a half-sunken sea fort crumble on an inlet. Beyond the Bay of Rivershaw, ghosts rise into the sky. The skyscrapers of La Delta, the financial district. Faint golden light seeps from the office windows. Will you ever go there? No, you are just one of the hundreds of thousands who watch them rise across the bay from Martinez every day. Urban coastline, rain dripping off Eatonite-covered roofs, cinder blocks left over from half-finished construction, a defunct research and development building once seized by revolutionaries. An old wooden church stands on stilts above the water. Coal City, end of all lines. Your hair is an oily mess flecked with ash from neighboring coal plants. Smokestacks rise somewhere in the distance. There's a frit on the corner. A plastic coat is folded into a small triangle under the counter by the window. Beyond that, the strike breakers have gathered. The great gates of the industrial harbor are locked. A chill runs down your back. You shudder like an animal trying to shake water from its hide. Behind the gates, heaps of supply crates, red and blue metal shipping containers, slick with rain. The Greater Rivershaw Industrial Harbor is an artificial mountain range. Immense wealth resides within, and immeasurable poverty in its shadow. La Drissienne, King Dries Passenger Harbor. Cruise ships flanked by dock arms, cranes watching over the mouth of the river distributary. Couron, the lower middle class. Distributary after distributary cuts the city blocks in half. Seven-story buildings trail off into the rain. A silvery curtain of rain over the houses, the class divide. Capeside apartments, tower blocks crowd one another. 4.46 millimeter bullets still lodged in their war-torn stone walls. Hallways collapse from the mortar hits of a war that was lost long ago. Clotheslines go to waste in the rain. Radios play. A yard. Rain falls onto the roof of a woodshed. Coal leaks into a puddle beneath a dead man's feet. He swings from a tree, bloated. Droplets of rain slip from his cold cheeks. Coalition-era statics hang like apparitions under the cloud cover. Way up there, where rain forms, rotors flutter silently. Your sight clears.
This rain will not let up anytime soon. You should get a raincoat. There's a freight to the east. They sell them there.
Welcome to Revachol.
Don't you welcome to Revachol me. My grandfather came here from a 3,000-year-old racist isolationist culture, while your ancestors came to this island a mere 300 years ago. Every school of thought and government has failed in the city, but I love it nonetheless. It belongs to me as much as it belongs to you. It's men like you who keep Revachol divided, making it that much harder for everyone to climb out of this post-war limbo.
Oh, come on, man. I just said welcome to Revachol. It's a lorry driver thing.
I know exactly what you meant. You think my kind doesn't belong here, that I should watch myself and behave. But you see, I'm an officer of the RCM. It's actually my job to make sure you behave. I would advise you to remember that.
Silence. The air between them becomes tense. Your partner needs backup. Now's your moment to shine.
You do make a cute couple. You know that?
The lieutenant exhales and resumes his regular calmness.
Whatever you say, officers.
He smells of heavy motor oils, and his breath of high tar content cigarettes, probably Astra Whites.
Oh, not much anymore. I'm here to pick up some cargo, but the dock workers are on strike, so it's a sit and wait on your ass situation. Apples? Yeah, apples? I take it you had other questions?
He's given you the runaround. Let's be honest. You were bested.
No.
He's got a smoke right there, in his fucking hand. Snatch that shit out of his fat fingers. You need it after listening to his garbage.
Can't have it. Evidence of what? I haven't done anything. I bet. Sorry, I couldn't be of any help. Drugs? They're shit, man. I don't let anything pollute my body. You know where that shit comes from? Sara Miridza, Safre, Ilmara. They take the money from our local junkies here and then use it to outcompete us in the manufacturing sector. They know they can't beat us in a fair fight, so they have to get us to weaken ourselves somehow. It's racial sabotage. Racial economic sabotage. Not in, not out. I'll never betray the purity of my tribe.
So you're telling us that you don't know anything about drug smuggling through Terminal B?
I don't know shit. If I did, I wouldn't tell you. What do you think? I can't leave the lorry unguarded. Stuff's been getting looted lately. It's those little kips sneaking around at night. If they touch my stuff, the bosses will be on my ass like ass cancer. Isn't it obvious? Fucking Sealing, that beady-eyed South Samaran. His little side business is a scam. I wouldn't be surprised if he was peddling drugs as well. He's a Samaran guy who likes to pretend he's some kind of businessman. Really, he's just selling his employer stuff. Stuff he stole after he broke the seals on his Humanox lorry. Just follow the smell. It smells like apricot and oil when you're nearby.
Yes, yes. Where is he?
Looks like I offended your partner there. Too bad. Sea Lang's usually a little bit south of here, near the canal. You can't miss him. Just watch yourselves. His tribe are natural liars. It's in their blood. He's your man, all right? 100%.
I wouldn't be so sure about it. Not until we've heard what Sea Lang himself has to say.
Guess so.
The tear machine stands in the corner. A sign says, one bottle equals 10 cents. Your bottles clunk into the machine, and the money appears with a satisfying jingle. You're a richer man now. You see several packaged raincoats fill a low shelf beneath a display of croissants and juice bottles. The raincoats are transparent, except for the big Fritte slogan on the back. The packages are small, discreet, sloppily stacked, making them easier to take unnoticed. No need to worry about knocking over a display.
Here you go. Welcome to Frit. Feel free to look around or something. Everything is out on the shelves.
What's that magazine she's reading?
I don't know. Frit? A 7-Eleven grocery store? I think they think that the extra tea makes it funkier. It doesn't. You mean this? This is Pop Stars. It's got, like, famous people in it. It's not for sale.
Looks like it also has something called Police de la Mode, featured on page 34. This speaks to you.
It's where they rate different outfits famous people wear. It's kind of funny. They're kind of mean. It's about who's the most stylish. No, I don't think so.
We are not the fashion police. We're the real police.
Okay. I'm not really supposed to be chatting to anyone, but... I don't really know anything. I mean, I know it's there, but I haven't seen it, so... Not really. No. I didn't know him at all. I don't know, really... long? I don't know.
No need to worry. It's just standard procedure for us to ask around. If you hear anything, let us know, okay?
Okay. Uh-huh. Reality. You mean, what reality? Economic reality, or... I don't know. What about it? We're in Frit? As mankind, or as a nation, or...
In a good place.
I mean, science is doing great, and this radio computer thing seems to be kinda big. I don't know. I don't know. Look at the clock. It's right behind you on the wall.
The clock shows the time at 10:09. The hands seem to be still. It's apparent the clock doesn't work.
When ordinary people take over the government and, demand democracy? Yeah, it happened like 50 years ago or so. Sorry, I'm not very good at this. At history, I mean.
Our government?
Or do you mean something else? Sorry, I...
Cool.
This appears to be some kind of machine with a cube-shaped heart and a wired framework. The keyboard has a rectangular on-off button. A piece of paper still hangs from the printer.
A radio computer. Just sitting here without anyone in sight.
This is the Ream Civic radio computer, model RC5120, equipped with a Feld mainframe and a Ream-compatible printer. The machine lights up like some prehistoric animal stirring from its slumber, revealing fluorescent play and print keys on the keyboard. That it's empty, like a beehive without its brood. Some cables have been left dangling, disconnected.
This is where the memory should go.
Nothing happens. Something's missing. There's no tape in the player. Nothing happens. Your flashlight slides over an old green chalkboard covered in scribbles, sketches, and schemes like some ancient cave mural. Some of the writing has faded with age, but you can still make out sections here and there. Photos and drawings have been pinned to the board. These lithe, pointy-eared creatures appear to be different types of welkins. You make out autumnal candle welkins casting wax-based magic, translucent welkins with organs shining under their skin, and even ether welkins hailing from the vast emptiness of sidereal space. Who are all those creatures? Fantasies of a tortured, feverish mind. One of the welkins, towering among the rest, appears to be different, however. It's Vara Hamira, a high welkin, his face white and scarred like cracked marble. This is clearly a welkin supremacist. The note says, all non-welkin races will be purged. The Haldor, the Tvorg, the humans, and even headless men, all of them, purged. Imagine a world filled only with welkin, green welkin, dread welkin, and the high welkin to rule them all.
An inordinate amount of time has gone into drawing these little welkin creatures. This looks like concept art for a project. It's not really real. Some people really like building a world, I think, even if it's just for a game. Political commentary. That one has a great beard, too. Just look at those details. So much effort.
The photo collage depicts barren, icy landscapes wrapped in perpetual night. You see permafrost and glacial landforms, dead trees grown in under the snow. Entire oceans have been frozen from shore to shore. There are pictures of settlements on dried-up riverbeds, abandoned in a storm. Animal corpses in the dark, carcasses and bones. You see primitive oil rigs built into glaciers, boreal dvorg, yurts under the snow, great mammoth-like beasts of burden. Albeit dark and cold, this vision also feels cozy in its own way, like eggnog or morphine, a much-needed respite from our own world. A pinned postcard reads, "The heat death scenario. A desperate fight for geothermal energy engulfs the world as Wirral becomes untethered from its sun, drifting through the universe." This is a monthly calendar from the year 50. Cryptic words like sprint, daily minimi, and GPI span the marker-drawn grid, the grand scheme of production and money. It looks a bit like an academic calendar, only much more brutal. As time goes on, the numbers in the boxes grow rarer and rarer. The board becomes an empty snowfield in the final days. Only failure and regret dwell in this region.
Looks like they didn't make it.
A note in the bottom left corner of the chalkboard says, "See the prod schedule filament for details." The handwriting is only partly legible, but you can still make out three slogans: "Call in, tune out, Wirral untethered," and "Heat Death of the Universe." The full text reads, "Heat Death of the Universe is the new black." Another note says, "The biggest advancement in role-playing systems since the 30s. Outside, a cold wind wraps the building in its bosom. Snowflakes in the wind. An old woman passes what the locals call the doomed commercial area. She tries hard not to look at the bookstore windows. It's unwise. On the cube are still smoldering. Like a smooth draw, the filament slides into place. On the bar of fabric right above the keyboard starts producing a soft hum. The sound of static seeps through the machine's planar magnetic driver. Oh no. It was already glowing and now it's also making a sound. It's probably some alien CO-like technology. The static gets louder, slowly filling up the abandoned horn. Until a voice speaks out, crackling and old, cutting into the air.
Good afternoon. Fortress accident en rue de Saint-Ghislaine. This is East Insulindian Repeater Station 1. Please repeat. Is this the production schedule? Yes, I am alive. I am 74 years old and my name is Yvonne. Now, please repeat. Is this the production schedule?
She repeats passwords. Programming people are all paranoid.
I work as a repeater at the East Insulindian Repeater Station. It's my job to know where you are for this accident. As for me, well, I am sitting in my cubicle. Surrounded by a wall of radios.
On an island on the river Esperance, a small woman, all skin and bones, sits in a room filled with audio equipment. Thousands of tiny lights are reflected back from her prescription lenses, like stars in the dark.
Now please tell me the reason for your call for this accident. The filament you have inserted into the reader. Yes. Is that the production schedule? Good. Please repeat the password. No. Still no. I am contractually obliged to protect the privacy of the filament holder for this accident. Without filing a warrant with Lintel, I cannot give you access to this filament.
I'm afraid we are not doing that, unless we want to wait for a month.
Now, can you please repeat the password? Received. I will register this login attempt.
That sounds bad. A login attempt. Something a criminal would do. Don't worry. Passwords have a way of turning up, sooner or later.
Fortress accident. Is there anything else I can do for you today? Thank you, and goodbye.
Tiles on the cube are still smoldering, casting the framework in a soft glow. Fluorescent plate, nothing happens. This old fireplace is covered in lines drawn in blue and red marker, the mesh spreading over the stone like blood vessels on alabaster skin. It looks ghostly and strangely ancient. Radio frequencies, it seems. UKV 123.6, UKV 123.7, UKV 123.9. Some written notes, too. Sparse and cryptic, unclear. It looks like a cardiovascular system split into veins and capillaries. Very advanced. You think so? The web is comprised of radio stations. All lead back to one red heart, titled The Game Master Frequency. A note says, this one can listen in on any station it wants. Looks like a surveillance program. They must have had massive air width. These things don't come cheap. Someone very important. The leader of a massive on-air game built by these people. Whoever decides to call in to a call-in station, it looks like. A list of names under the stations suggests people across 6 Isolas would be playing. Muindi, Insulinda, Kotla, Grad, Samara, and even Il Mara. There's no way a little basement studio working here could pull anything like this off.
My God. It's as if the less money they had, the more ambitious their project became. Exactly. This schedule, I know doom when I see it. The company was running out of funding.
Nothing. It's just lines on marble. An echo from times long gone. No one has used the fireplace in ages.
Okay. What do you think is going on with that computer, chalkboard, and fireplace? Yes, that is the question.
Like he's ready to lay out a fine theory, crafted together like a puzzle box.
It looks like one of those popular pen and paper role-playing games. Only these people were trying to automate it, make it work on radio computers. Not to my knowledge. They make automated games in Grad, Messina, Königstein. You know, places with industry. But I don't think anyone has attempted to create an inter-isolary game before. We just don't have the technology. Through call-in stations, none of the players have to be physically present. Anyone in the world can participate in the game, as long as they have a two-way radio. Then there's the game master frequency that listens in on the smaller call-in stations. I think that was supposed to coordinate the stories, functioning as a master of ceremonies of sorts.
His fascination has swept aside other concerns for the moment. He's a little hooked. Coordinating so many games would take a whole switchboard of people, possibly divided into sub-frequencies.
Indeed, those Welkins are a dead giveaway. Role-playing people love that stuff. The world looks like a modified version of the Wii World board game, with Hit Death thrown in. No idea. They stopped filling out the schedule on the chalkboard. Indeed, it's ambitious and untethered from reality, but... it's too late for that, I'm afraid. Okay, let's keep moving.
few bricks have fallen off, revealing a compartment behind the wall. It's too dark to see in.
There is, yes. And there also appears to be something inside the hole. Interesting.
Your hand reaches deep into darkness and spiderwebs, rummaging around. You find rusty rifles hidden away.
Are these any good?
Most of them are rusty and inoperable, like the rest. But one catches your eye, a bolt-action model with a fine woodstock, in better cosmetic order than the others.
That's a rare sight. Seems to no longer be functional, but still a beautiful thing in its own way. Seems like an old bunker from the revolutionary period. Look at all those rifles. Must be an old weapons cache. It means there are firearms, albeit inoperable, still lying around in Martinez. It's an interesting coincidence, I would say. Might come in useful in the future.
He likes this find. Two cables are plugged into the breaker box. The red one leads off into the darkness, and the black one to the ice cream maker nearby. Rip the red one out. Look how giant and red and inviting it is. Don't rip the red one out. You'll awaken the ghosts. Something close to you dies with a soft electric purr.
Why did you do that?
The lieutenant raises his brows, but doesn't say anything. Terrifying ice bear with a strange compartment in its belly. The door is covered in frost and the bear's eyes are glowing red. This ice bear is a hypercarnivore. Be careful. The lieutenant doesn't answer. His eyes are glued to the animal. A sharp slice of light shines out from its mysterious belly door. A gust of freezing cold air rushes to greet you. You hear a low grumble as the bear regulates itself. This is the inside of a refrigerator. The lieutenant takes a peek inside. His hand has found the holster of his gun. The shelves are empty. All you see are crumpled ice cream wrappers with the brand name, Revachol Ice City. A handwritten note has been attached to the door. You pocket the note and the little fridge magnets keeping it on the door. A friendly cartoon bear smiles back at you from a glossy cellophane wrapper. It looks nothing like the fridge. The paper still smells of vanilla and chocolate.
Good question. It looks like an ice cream fridge.
Somewhere in the past, it's summer. Five-year-old Fifette lets go of her mother's hand, change jingling in her pockets as she hops towards the ice cream stand right across the plaza.
I know. What an unfortunate marketing choice. What is even worse, the bear is still costing them money to this day.
The fridge buzzes with energy. The electricity bill on this thing must be catastrophic. note is written with a blue pencil on a piece of lined office paper. The kitchen magnets have left spots on its surface.
Does it say anything interesting?
This is tangential at best, but the lieutenant's detective instinct is still active. Someone has scribbled, S, I can't believe the off-site copy is still here. The illiterate ginger kid keeps stealing stuff from the studio, so I had to hide it somewhere safe. You'll find the filament memory with the off-site copy in the frozen ice cream maker. Please take it home, ASAP. It's important. I'd do it myself if I lived in a civilized place with a freezer. Take care, Sulisuaf.
Looks like someone from that radio game company upstairs. I'm a little surprised they just left their property lying here. That's a plausible hypothesis. I don't know. I assume it's somewhere close to the ice bear fridge.
Didn't you see one right next to the breaker box? This orange machine is dead still. It has a hand-cranked ice cream churner and an electric You slip your fingers under the frozen lid, but the ice is too cold for you to get a good grip. No, this is going to need something else, some kind of super pry bar. Don't even try to open it with a regular pry bar. You're just wasting your time. If you want to try again, then you need to have the pry bar in your hand, Detective.
Equip the pry bar by going to the tools tab in your
This orange machine is dead still. It has a hand-cranked ice cream churner and an electric freezer. The ice around it slowly melting. The ice squeaks beneath the pry bar. You think you've got the bar jammed in there pretty well, but the lid simply won't budge. You see the pry bar's metal handle bending right before your very eyes.
Yeah, well, that's a good pry bar. I'm not criticizing it. But this ice cream maker is frozen shut. It takes an advanced tool to get it open. I have no idea, officer. This ice cream maker isn't important enough to requisition a special tool.
Sooner or later, you will stumble upon a tool mighty enough. Then we will know what's in this mysterious ice cream maker. Only the red cable is plugged into the... Somewhere, a machine hums along with the current, happy and contented. An electric sizzle. The room is slightly quieter now. His eyes are dead and empty. A thick layer of coal dust covers the furnace, coloring it pitch black. Looks like this furnace has a face, and it's a face of agony.
Looks like it. Looks like an old central furnace used to heat the building. It's connected to the chimney. No one has used it in ages. No signs of any recent fire. Only dead rats.
It's dark and grimy here. In the darkness you can hear chatter. It's coming from above. A voice or several voices talking to each other. Near the smoke chamber. Upstairs. The echo is so prominent, it's impossible to discern what the voices are saying or what's producing them.
What are you doing? Wait, really? We should investigate, see if someone's upstairs.
A lush layer of coal now covers your skin, sinking into the wrinkles. Your hands look ancient. Maybe you could paint something with this coal. Leave a cave painting for future archaeologists. No, that would be stupid. Still, it's good to have this dirt on you. Real men wear coal for makeup. Thick layer of coal, a hollow ring echoes through the furnace. Your toe hurts. Iron safety curtain curves before your eyes, folded like a bellows. It covers half the room, blocking the way into a colossal industrial chimney. This is directly above the central furnace in the cellar. The voices probably came from here. What an odd thing to do. Nothing happens. Still nothing. No one's home. Those curtains prove to be surprisingly sturdy. Your fist hurts now.
There must be another way to wake up whoever is in there. Maybe we should ask the lady in the bookstore what's going on here.
Bent metal. Broken glass. Your path lies strewn with the broken forms of everyday objects. You are the destroyer. The bane of inanimate matter. Kudos.
You broke down the back door, the wards, the door. It's all gone now. Dark psychic energy leeching onto my shop. I suppose it's all over now. I guess there's no escape. Just a door? This place is cursed, Detective. They don't call it the doomed commercial area for nothing. Just look at the sheer amount of companies that have failed in this house. I hope you're happy now. Happy that you've ruined everything. Now that you've broken the door, the curse is coming to get me as well.
Host Almighty, she prays. Guard me and my honest business venture from the curse that lurks behind the door. Blessed be your name.
Of course you didn't. You're nothing but a policeman. All right, you know what? I'm willing to let you investigate the doomed commercial area. We are set on the path. There's little else to do.
Her facade has dropped. Now you see the curiosity behind the fear.
But before we go on, tell me, did you encounter the malignant entity? You did?
Then it has to be true. I've suspected that this woman-shaped energy must be connected to the curse ever since I first saw her. Did you see that she lives inside the chimney? Yes, I've heard that. It's enormous. She has barricaded herself behind some metal security curtains upstairs. God knows what she's doing there. Some unnatural magic, I assume. You should go find the entity and ask what happened to all the companies in the building. And do return to me after you've talked to it. I'm quite anxious to know what she has to say about the curse.
If you're really interested in cracking this mystery, then we should go back to the furnace. Maybe you could yell into it or something. Make some noise. You'll think of something. You always do.
Oh, I'm very sorry, sir. Some of these old paperbacks just don't have the durability. I would be happy to sell you another one, but unfortunately, it's the last copy we had in stock.
A thick layer of coal dust covers the furnace, coloring it pitch black. Something breaks loose in you. A mighty bellow echoes throughout the chimney's depths. The chatter of tiny voices above suddenly cease. Then,
hello?
You've awakened the entity.
Hello? Did you say anything? I can't hear you. Please come upstairs. There's a safety curtain on the second floor. I'll open it.
You hear a low rumble upstairs. The sound of a curtain being pulled aside.
After you, officer.
Hello, I'm Nia. Did you try knocking on my window? I must have missed you. I've been listening to my Milius. So what kind of die are you looking for?
Could this be the malicious entity? Perhaps it's wise to go along with this masquerade for now.
Yes, a Milius is like a call-in station. You need a two-way radio to access one. That's why I have these. Mostly, they just teach you to swear in different languages. But some of the stations can be quite interesting. I was so absorbed, I must have missed you knocking. Then how did you get inside? By the south entrance? You know what? It doesn't even matter. What matters is that you're finally here. Let's talk dice. Did you have something specific in mind? I'm a novelty dice maker. Tell me the name of your role-playing system and I'll make the die you need. That's why you're here, yes?
As she speaks, her bone-like fingers fiddle with a ring. Her bones light, but her hands strong. Role-playing games? You know the one made by Fortress Accident. Does that count?
Very good. My rate is 10 real per set. Unless you want something really unusual. Take a look around and see if there is any particular stone you want to use. Nothing really. I didn't know him.
Who cares about the dead body? We might be dealing with a malignant entity here.
The lieutenant looks at his notebook, then the woman under the large window.
Your window looks directly onto the courtyard. You're saying you didn't see or hear anything unusual last Sunday evening?
I'm sorry, detective, but as you know, I usually have my headphones on when I'm working. It shuts out most of the daily ruckus behind my window. Well, there's always something going on in the Whirling's backyard. During daytime, there are usually those kids. And lately, I've been seeing a lot of drunk workers hanging about. Must be because of the strike. But I never saw anyone during that fateful Sunday night, I'm afraid. I might have, but in this case, all I would have seen is my own reflection staring back from the darkness. It's really hard to make anything out in the yard when it's dark outside. Besides, I rarely get up to look out the window when I'm in the zone. It's an odd profession, making dice for people, but I like it, and I prefer doing this to sitting at home.
She nods.
Anything else, officer? How did I become one? It was a business decision. I was a regular jeweler at first, but that's an unfocused field with too much competition. Some of my friends were role players. They asked me to make some polyhedral dice out of cobalt. That was my first order. I grew it from there. Not especially. I like working with rare materials and a steady pay. And role players as customers? They're nice people. Of course. Tell me what you have in mind. What do you mean by cursed? Alright, how about I surprise you? Come back in 8 hours with 7 real and I'll give you your cursed. Maybe you have some other ideas for dice? Ah, yes, fortress accident. It's too bad they never finished their game. The Wiro untethered die is a variation of a standard role-playing die. Only, instead of plants, it uses motifs of ice and death. And loss, of course. I'm thinking something made from alligator jawbone, cast in black resin. The reptile bone is as white as ice and dead as, well, death. For 7 real, I could have it ready in 8 hours. Great, see you in 8 hours then. Was there anything else? We're inside the chimney of an old central furnace. It's strange, I know. But when I arrived here, all the other rooms were taken, so I had to build myself a makeshift home. Besides, I don't really have to pay any rent here, so that's a plus.
Plaisance was right. There's an entity living in the chimney. You should ask her about the curse.
Creative.
I've heard the stories, but I don't think those stories are true. Plaisance, the bookshop lady? I've heard that her business is doing rather well. Have the energies spared her somehow? Oh, right. But it's not just the bookstore that's still up and running. What about the Whirling in Rags? Some people say it's part of the building complex. And then there is me. I've been here for 14 years, selling novelty dice to role-playing enthusiasts. Not exactly a million real business idea, yet somehow I've survived despite the talk of malicious energies. Strange, isn't it?
It's because she's in cahoots with the demons.
I was just about to ask, what do you think? Do you think the curse is real?
The jig is up. The she-demon knows you've uncovered her true identity. Time has come to face the source. Fear not, for the forces of the universe are supporting you in this psychic quest.
Is it now? I've always thought it's a rather mundane and boring place with no supernatural surprises in sight. Well, if you ever find a way to explain all those inconsistencies in the curse, let me know.
You feel nothing. If anything, it's uncomfortably warm in here.
Excuse me, what are you doing?
Officer!
And why would you do that? And what technique is that?
Miss, I apologize for my colleague's behavior. He's still recovering from an unusual medical episode.
Officer, this isn't how mature adults deal with their feelings.
Now you feel something. The cold damp of shame washing over you.
The air pressure told you to take your pants off in my studio? Can you please employ this special technique somewhere else? I work here and my work requires concentration. Half-naked people don't help with that. More or less, are you interested in anyone specific?
Rats scuttle in the dark rooms under the abandoned blow dryers and dusty mannequins. Cobwebs cover rotors and radio computers alike. So much failure.
It wasn't merely a gym, it was Artemideps Boxing Club, a community project created to steer at-risk youth away from drugs and crime. A kind man from Zhemsk. I heard he had some trouble with the law when he was younger, and that's why he wanted to start the gym, as his way of giving back. It didn't. If anything, it made the youth situation in Martinez even worse. At some point, someone started a rumor that the punching bag downstairs was full of amphetamines.
You should have known it.
Eventually, the coalition took away the funding and the club went bankrupt. This was a few years ago. It's gotten much more peaceful around the plaza ever since. You mean Mr. Fabron, the taxidermist? No, he mostly just did drugs.
But what drugs exactly?
He got high on some weird taxidermy chemicals. I wouldn't recommend it to anyone. Eventually, they caused him to lose control of his bladder. The smell was awful.
Even you can probably do better than that.
Oh, this one's a mess. There used to be a company that promised to repair windows 24 hours a day. What could go wrong with this one, right? Turns out, the business was actually set up as a front for an illicit group that was producing snuff medias. Who would have guessed? And they never cleaned up the debris either. Now it's just littering the hallway and I have no idea how to get rid of it on my own. It's a Sub Rosa radio station that broadcasts real murders with real victims. Some people pay good money to get off on it.
What does she mean, to get off on it?
Don't worry, the ICP has a separate division that deals exclusively with unlicensed Sub Rosas. This isn't our problem.
Good luck with that. It's not easy catching those perpetrators. Yes, I think it was called Androgynous Orlando or something similar. They weren't a big hit around here. Turns out that working class men don't like genderless haircuts. They're scared of that word.
You wouldn't like it either. The others would laugh at you. It's not about the haircut. It's about the confidence.
I guess it just wasn't the time yet. There used to be a fashion atelier here, but I have forgotten the head designer's name. They were doing well for a couple of years, until the insect rights activists came. The atelier produced a certain collection that used chitin among the materials. Apparently chitin is made in the Occident, where it's extracted from beetle wings. And you know how all kinds of political movements are big in the Occident. The activists shut down the biggest chitin supplier, which of course caused the price to skyrocket. And, naturally, All the most fashionable tastemakers refused to be seen in Kaiten from then on. The atelier went bankrupt before they could finish the collection. Really? Anyway. They were made by a company called Slipstream. After they pivoted from making rotor blades to skis, their chief executive took off on a vacation with all their money. Honestly, I think it's quite funny. I think he's still sending out holiday transmissions from Tulula or Tiumotiri or Hashkor or wherever he is. The usual, I imagine. But he's been thinking up all kinds of new business plans and can't wait to get started on them just as soon as he returns.
Men like that are a curse.
Sure, but Slipstream is history now. All their remaining assets got seized by the bailiffs in 47. I have no idea why those skis and blades are still lying around in the house. Not much use now, I guess.
Maybe you could make a sword out of one. No, wait, forget it. It would take too long.
Fortress Accident, the radio game studio. They were an interesting bunch. We talked about role-playing systems every now and then. Once, I even saw two of them get into fisticuffs over Wirral. They certainly took their work very seriously, even if they seemed to be chronically liberal with their schedules. The usual, they ran out of money and couldn't get the project done on time. Well, I did hear them talking at times. They seemed to believe they were historical individuals on some grand quest. Yes, but when the money started to run out, they just began to complain a lot about capitalism. You know, how the markets are rigged to keep out new businesses and so on. In the end, they just didn't get it done. They didn't have enough willpower to produce something truly historic and to show up to work on time.
Showing up to work on time is hard. No, scratch that. Showing up to work at all is difficult. Especially if you've been drinking.
And so is producing something extraordinary. Anything else? Oh boy, the fabled Rever Show, ICT. You're in for a treat here. The place was owned by two guys who had some rather innovative ideas about marketing. The Bear was one of them. Now ask me about their other ideas. There was really just one, and it involved picking out the prettiest girls in the neighborhood and paying them 20 cents per hour to man the booth. And by man the booth, I mean slump behind the counter with a face that could maim you if you ever dared to disturb their bored magazine browsing.
Fritte does the same thing.
Employing silky teenage girls is a widespread practice, yes. Unfortunately, they always come in packs. I'm talking about acne-ridden girlfriends and gorilla-like boyfriends loitering near the shop. At least that's what happened with Rever Show ICT, and they already had the Bear. The Bear. Of course not. The Bear was terrifying. No one wants ice cream guarded by a hostile apex predator. To make matters worse, the fridge didn't work too well either. And half the ice cream came out malformed and partially melted. Eventually, Rever Show ICT lost the price war to its rival, Glace 5000. Glace 5000 sold caramel sundaes for only 5 cents apiece, out of regular fridges. You did what? Really? You broke it? What a shame. It was a terrifying beast, but I was fond of it. The taxidermist who made it said it was his vision beast. He said he met his vision beast while high on desiccants. He called it Megatherion.
Scary, but cool.
Megatherion, a mega wild beast. It's an imaginary beast that guides you through life by telling you to do more drugs, mostly.
A wise and noble beast. Guiding you toward the land where the streets are paved with drugs.
Very good. You shouldn't do them. You're a police officer after all. Anyway, now you know the story of the fall.
The temperature has dropped in the cover of the night. You see frost on the windows.
Anything else? Another failed business, perhaps? I've been here for a long time. Oh, right. I hope you didn't try to ring me. I think none of those doorbells work, including mine. I'm still in the middle of connecting the wires. It's the one with an empty name card. It's the last one in the list. As I said, it's quite useless right now. It doesn't work yet. Sure, I'm listening. Good. I hope it clarified things a bit. What else?
Mazovian Socioeconomics. 0.000% of communism has been built. Evil child-murdering billionaires still rule the world with a shit-eating grin. All he has managed to do is make himself sad. He is starting to suspect Krasmezov fucked him over personally with his socio-economic theory. It has, however, made him into a very smart boy with something like a university degree in truth. Instead of building communism, he now builds a precise model of this grotesque, duplicitous world.